Welcome to CNET's live coverage of Google I.O. 2019. This is Google's big developer conference. They hold this every year. We see crazy things every year. I'm Iyaz Akhtar, alongside Vanessa and Orellana and Patrick Holland, and behind
the board,
we've got Beecham, who's taking care of all the things. So we've got some time before Sundar Pichai hits the stage for his big keynote. That's going to be at 10 a.m. Pacific. You guys can let us know what you think. Tweet us with the hashtag CNETLive, because we'll be looking for that. Otherwise, we won't see it. Or you can just tweet to us directly, and we'll do our best to get back to you guys. So in the past, guys, we've seen all kinds of new things at Google I.O. They introduced Google Home at this event. We always see new versions of Android there. And again, that makes a lot of sense since this is the developers conference, so we should see cool things there. Vanessa, what do you want to see out of this year's Google I.O.?
Okay, I'm going to start off a little bit boring, but I guess I want to see what I'm going to use the most. So I'm interested mostly in the updates to services, new features on things like Gmail, Google Photos. I want to see what's going on with Duplex. Am I going to finally have that assistant that I really, really want? And search, things that I use on a daily basis but may not have like the wow factor that you've been talking about. You know, I'm not... Obviously, you know, Waymo and the developments in healthcare, that's exciting. But honestly, I just want to see what's going to affect me tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting point, because Google's apps and search and services touch a lot more people than just its hardware or their weird little like projects on the side of your digital health well-being in Android. That's really great, but that's for a very select few people who have the latest version of Android. But developments in maps and apps and even the iOS search stuff, that's going to be very important. What do you think, Patrick?
Man, that's a good list. I don't know. I have actually just two that pop out to me. One is obviously I'm a hardware guy. I like phones. And there's been one or two small leaks about some possible new Pixel phones, which
really?
Be very exciting. Yeah.
I didn't see them.
Yeah.
Nobody saw them.
Just one or two. I don't know if you saw them or not.
No.
They were on a small little picture of a phone here and there.
Okay.
And yeah,
someone must have missed it.
Yeah, it's on someone's Twitter.
I'm pretty sure Google leaked their own hardware this year as well. So not a lot of surprises in terms of hardware, at least like consumer.
At least that's the rumor. We could be totally wrong.
I don't think so.
All speculation here. And the other thing, too, is we can talk a little more about these leaks a second. The other thing, but if there are new phones, I'm excited to see what they are. Obviously, I think the Pixel 2 and 3 have had the best camera on them for photos, mm-hmm. by far, ahead of any other camera you can get right now. Be interested to see if that goes to a new phone or if it's a lower price phone. Because
Patrick!
I know, right?
And, How do you know?
I don't know. Well, again, leaks. Okay, so there's that. The other thing is actually something last year that I was really excited about was they had for directions in Google Maps, mm-hmm. you follow
the fox.
The fox, right? Which is a combination of AR and their AR core using that. And I'm curious to see what updates are doing to that. So are we going to get other cool features like follow the fox or other cool AR implementation on our phones and devices?
Well, clearly they're going to upgrade their John Legend plan. If you guys don't know, John Legend's voice is available on Google Assistant devices. So if you want to turn that on Google Home, you could do that. So maybe we could have a virtual or augmented reality version of John Legend, or maybe Childish Gambino, like they already have.
Yeah, or maybe John Legend riding a fox to show you that.
It could be.
Your Childish Gambino would be like your destination marker or something.
I know I'm just thinking this in jest, but honestly, you have to have a lot of cool software features for these devices. When they introduced the Pixel last year, we apparently knew everything about the 3. We knew about the hardware look, but the thing that blew away people was their camera software, mm-hmm. making Night Sight or Night Shot look amazing. So there definitely has to be more developments in the software side, because hardware is great. You're right. The camera is great. But without the software side to support it, it doesn't do as well, because we've seen Google work with minimal amount of hardware. Mm-hmm. We've got other phones with 2, 3, 4 cameras in the back, and Google's sticking to one on the 3, the 2, and the 1 original Pixel. So the software is still super important. And these little tricks, like I'm saying, I really think that would actually get people excited, because it's such a weird thing, but it reaches the masses.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good point what you bring up, because, you know, we are getting so many cameras on phones now, and they managed to do portrait mode and things that, you know, other phones needed multiple cameras to do, and they've been able to do it with software. And this is why this is so exciting, because it's going to be those tweaks that are actually going to affect us users. And, you know, with Google Photos as well, that you can now enhance photos mm-hmm. that you've taken post or in post-production. And these are the features that are small but are have the most potential of impact, in my opinion. And obviously, you know, there's big healthcare stuff that it might save lives.
And
but
we should talk about that too. But I think just to close off the thought of the photos and stuff, what's interesting too is if you make improvements to something and no one has to do anything more on their end. If I'm a user and I don't have to do anything more, it's like your pictures will just look better. It's like, that's great. And if there is this rumored phone, if it is more price friendly, I don't know if we're going to see like a new camera or a giant improvement to that software. But heck, if they can get like that Pixel 3 camera and put in a more affordable body, like I think that could be really compelling. And then also, I'm excited, obviously, with Android Q. We've had taste of some fun things in there, but usually it's this event is when we're going to find out some of the big features that we have not seen.
Wait. You're actually excited about Android
Mostly
Q
Mostly because
right
what the
now.
Heck is Q going to stand for, guys?
Mainly, yes.
What the heck is Q going to stand for?
Quiche
is not sweet, though.
It's not, okay.
For those of you who
are
they kind of a dessert, though?
I don't think so. Unless I'm thinking about the different quiche. Right? I don't know.
I'll have to Google if there's a sweet quiche, but for those of you who have no idea what we're talking about.
That's my MySpace handle was sweet quiche.
Sweet quiche. So. Android builds have been codenamed with names of desserts, I think, since Donut, I want to say, or before that was Cupcake. We've had a bunch of those. So each new generation has a new name. The last one was Pie. Before that was Oreo. And then I had to do the alphabet backwards, so I'm going to forget that. But Q, again, a very strange one when it comes to what dessert. I don't think there's even a brand name dessert that goes with it.
No, you're wrong. In the South, there was a brand called Quality Candies for a long time. I'm not even making this up. So maybe it's Android Quality Candies 10.
Well,
Android 10 Quality Candies.
Okay, if we're going to get that nitty gritty, I'm going to throw this out there. In El Salvador, where I'm from, there is a quesadilla, which is spelled with a Q, obviously, but it's a sweet quesadilla. It doesn't look anything like what you're used to, like the Mexican quesadilla, but it's like a sponged cake made with cheese, and it's called a quesadilla.
I think you're going to have to bring one of these back.
Fine.
So like we can just verify this. So.
No, it's like a sponge cake, but yeah, you would think that it looks like a crepe because of the Mexican quesadilla, but no, it's totally different. It's like something you drink with, you would eat with coffee, like a sweet cake. Right. Anyway, that's probably not it. Probably not it.
Quality candies.
I'm waiting on this. but the fact that we're discussing the code name more than anything is a little bit, that's kind of sad.
That's what people want, though, Iyaz. They want what damn Q stands for, and they want the Fox of John Legend writing it.
Okay, for myself, what I'm excited about.
What are you excited about?
Because
we didn't ask you. I'm sorry.
I'm gonna ask me.
We're going on a Q rant here.
No, I can.
What are you excited about?
I can talk to me for hours. Okay, so my old standbys, we still don't know what the heck's going on with Google Fuchsia. Anybody remember that? This potential thing that could replace Android and Chrome OS. It's supposed to be this homegrown thing that might have been in Google Home and not using Android things. This is a very deep cut kind of thing. If you don't know it, Google it later.
But that was also going to be something that was not competitive with those other platforms. Was this an alternative, right?
Yeah, because Android was mired in a lot of lawsuits and there was code base issues, so this thing being redone was somewhat important. So the question is, will this be the future? Can it replace it? There's no real roadmap or timeline on that, unfortunately, because what is this thing? What is it used for? But it's been around in the public eye for a while, so it'd be nice to get some kind of idea on that. VR stuff, we saw the Oculus with the self-contained unit. There's also the, I think Valve was one of them that came out with one as well. But Daydream hasn't had a huge update in a while. You still pop a phone in it. Maybe it's about time that Google comes out with its own Daydream view that's self-contained with more degrees of freedom. Because if you're adding all these cool features, if you're adding it to Android and you can have these depth maps and you can do augmented reality, it might be of some use there. So these are the smaller things I was looking for this I.O.
Well, in the last year or two, we've seen a lot of these Google VR 180 cameras coming out, which support that stuff for a VR headset like a Daydream would be as well. And also, they have a small little platform they own called YouTube. You may have heard of it. And that supports VR 180. So it would be interesting to see if
VR 180?
Yeah, so that's basically gives you a little bit better picture, but in a it has less pixels spread out, so you're not doing a full 360.
We're getting a call, guys. VR.
Hang on 1 second.
And we're going to keep talking until the call's alive here.
Yes.
But Iyaz, I would say this, going back to your wish list here, I have more of a question for you.
Do you
think that, because we see these years with iOS as well, where there's the big step forward and there's like, we're going to fix all the things in the background, which is kind of what you want a lot. Do you think this is going to be more of those big step forward years or more of a fix the things in the background?
I think Pi did a bit of that housekeeping when it came to making things faster on older hardware. And so if let's say Google is coming out with a more budget device and budget devices are more important, having a something like Android Q be able to run much smoother and much better on multitasking on lower powered hardware would be very important. Plus, you got all these smart devices that have Android built in. So you could see some of that in the background. I think it's just the best interest of Google to do that.
It's funny you say that, because when Android 9 Pi came out, I was testing a Razer phone too. And at initial test, the battery wasn't so great. But when I ran it with Android 9 Pi, I got 2 to 3 more hours battery life just because of the software change.
They're supposed to be using a lot more AI to determine how much you use the phone, what settings could be changed at different times of the day. So when you hear AI, you're like, AI sounds like this magic thing. It doesn't seem like anything. But when you find out it improves your battery life, now you care.
Yeah.
We've got Lexi on the line. She's actually at I.O. right now. We're in the studio, but she's in Mountain View. Lex, what's it like right now
Mountain View?
Hi, Lexi.
Hi, friends. Oh, okay. So it's like a party here. There is a full-on DJ set going down. And so Google has started off with a set from a human DJ and an AI DJ. So it's actually pretty fun. It's kind of like a little bit deep housey, a little bit kind of like getting some, you know, high BPMs on at 9 a.m. on a Tuesday morning, like with a rocking out. I don't know if I can flip around the camera just to show you a little bit about what is going on here. So down there, way down in the distance, you can see there is a human DJ. His name is Now, and there is an AI DJ choosing the tunes and spinning in like different tracks based on what he's playing. So it's kind of cool. I actually think that it's a pretty decent set. Like, I'm really quite enjoying it, even though I just feel like I'm in a club and everyone else is partying in the front row.
Which one is better, Lexi? Who's the better DJ?
So this is tough. I mean, I am partial to what the human DJ is playing, but it's really seamless. Like, you can't really tell. There was a technical glitch at the start, but they had to restart it. But I'm really enjoying it, and I can't really tell.
You need coffee. Now, this sounds like the most Silicon Valley thing ever. Like, hey, we got a live DJ, and we're going to make an AI one.
It so is.
How can you tell which one is spinning the tunes?
Because Lexi used to be a DJ, by the way.
Just like Idris Elba.
So, I'm giving the AI DJ some pretty high marks here. The human DJ, though, I think just has the edge. So what has been happening over the past, 10, 15 minutes, the AI DJ has been, I don't know if you can hear now, it's announcing, I am choosing the next track. Oh. So, that kind of gives you an idea of what's happening because, you know, a good DJ set, you shouldn't be able to tell, like, when the songs are really, like, mixing that much. It's just, like, the vibe keeps going. And so I guess, like, the announcement is just to give you an idea of, oh, hey, this is just so if you don't know how it works, you know, the AI DJ is choosing the tune now. The human DJ hasn't been saying when his tracks have been playing, but I can tell because I think both of them are pretty good, but I think I like the human ones a little bit more. So the robots haven't quite taken over just yet, but it's still really, really cool and fun to watch. There's a bunch of people down the front row just going crazy, which is really fun.
Do you have one of those capture codes to, like, fool the robot or not to see if, like, he could figure out if there are four roofs in the pictures or whatever?
Yeah, exactly. And so there hasn't been too much else around. I'll just give you a bit of a tour around what else is here. This is the amphitheater right now. So as you can see, it's like full to the brim with developers and other Google aficionados. It's sort of in the back rows. We have the press areas here. Then we have some more developers and some other VIPs down at the front. And we have been playing a little game of Spot the Google Glass. So far, we have seen two headsets, would you believe? There are two Google Glass on the ground so far. So we're keeping out for some more. I'm also looking for those coveted Google Wave badges as well, and all of the other now defunct Google products. So we'll see who else is repping them. So that's our tally so far, too. I'll keep you updated if I see any more. But so far, I mean, the vibe is it's a little bit of a party, given that the music's happening. It does seem a little bit more subdued compared to previous years in terms of the crowd. I mean, obviously, we're like 10, 15 minutes away now, so it's not as jam-packed yet. But I think there is still some reserved seating that is yet to be filled with even more VIPs. I haven't seen anyone else yet in terms of big execs from Google or other companies, but I'm keeping my eyes peeled, so I'll let you know if I do see them.
Well, keep us posted on the defunct Google products. That way we can take shots of coffee over here as soon as you post them on Twitter. We'll be... we'll be really hyped up at the end of the live show, hopefully.
Will do. Well, two Google Glass so far, so two shots of espresso for you all.
One quick question. So I saw there's trivia on the actual screens behind the DJs. Do you have any hints of what's coming because of the trivia?
No hints so far, although there was something about the first Google server racks were built from Legos, even though it's technically Lego. They did get that one wrong. Plexiglass and something else. And the answer was Lego. So there you go. I didn't know that. But I haven't heard. Oh, here's the question right now. Here you go. What were the first Google servers made of? Legos, stir sticks, or plexiglass?
That's definitely Lego.
Definitely Lego. Google should know better.
And Lego is all caps too, by the way.
Yes, yeah, exactly. So yeah, no other hints so far from the trivia on screen yet. So it's just been a lot of some great geeky references to coding. There's been, some XKCD comic references too. So yeah, definitely a lot of references out there for the developers, but nothing on Q or what Q might be in terms of Android so far. There was no food either that I could see that was Android Q based. So
we've been talking about like ethnic desserts because obviously Q is a really, really hard dessert to come up with. So Lexi, is there anything Australian that starts with a Q that might be sweet? I already told my Salvadorian one, but they weren't impressed. So
no,
maybe
we
you can help
we
us
not.
Out.
I was impressed.
The only thing that I can think of is Quick. It's the Nesquik.
Yes.
It's the milk drink. And
why?
So we just used to call it Quick, but now I think it's branded Nesquik. So that is my bet for what it might be. The Q might be.
You just solved the mystery, Lexi.
All right,
thank
go home.
You.
Well,
got it.
We'll
you
see.
Good.
You've done your job. You can go home now.
So Lexi, at the last Apple event, there were some giant, enormous amounts of celebrities. Have we seen any celebrities at the developer conference?
No. Or large celebrities?
None so no far. I have to say, the only celebs have been the people that are rocking the Google Glass to me, because that takes some courage. But I haven't seen anyone else noteworthy in terms of a celeb so far. Obviously, being a developers event, I'm not really expecting anybody except for obviously who's going to be on stage. But you never know. If I do, you'll be the first to know. I promise,
I heard,
Patrick.
Like, Chris Evans, he's a big developer. I'm sure he'd be there, like,
he's done
making his Android apps.
He's done doing his stuff, so he might as well.
Yeah, he's done with Avengers. So,
Lexi, we were also talking about what we're most excited to see at Google I/O today, and you know, we kind of had different opinions. Patrick was more about hardware. I was a little bit more about like services, and Iyaz was more about future facing. And what are you excited about?
Oh yeah, that's a good one. I mean, I'm really excited to see.
Other than
obviously,
Google Glasses, obviously.
Yeah, well,
second gen, third gen.
Exactly. Apart from that, no, I'm really excited to actually see, because last year at I/O there were a lot of those like really big show-stopping announcements, such as Duplex, and there was also that AR walking feature within Google Maps.
Yeah.
I'm really hoping that, you know, it's been a year since we had those announcements. I'm really hoping we actually finally see some concrete evidence of like when we're going to get these functionalities. It's not as sexy as your future hardware and all that. I just want the stuff that they told us they were doing, and it's actually going to come to our phones sooner rather than later. So that's really what I'm hoping for, and I hope there's going to be some more Duplex news, because that
yes.
was so crazy last year. I remember sitting here and everyone was just kind of just like, what? So maybe we'll see some more then. I really hope so. Fingers crossed for some more of that stuff that we saw last year finally coming to our phones.
I'm totally with you, Lexi. I second that motion.
Thanks, Lex. Thanks for giving us a view inside, and we'll get back to you later, I guess.
Yeah.
Bye.
That is a party atmosphere for early in the morning.
Yeah, it's a little
early. I don't know if I could handle all the jams this early.
Well, it's going to be a deep dive into like the energy level. I mean, Sundar Pichai is not exactly known for like running on stage with, you know, flamethrowers or diving out of airplanes.
Hey, you don't know about
you
that.
You never know. Actually, remember that time where they did dive?
Yeah,
that was Paige. Paige and Brynn. Those guys are nuts.
Yeah.
Pichai's got his head on straight.
That's true.
He's also been like dealing with Congress a lot, so I would expect him to kind of stay low key. Google's had a lot of weird stuff going on lately. Probably don't want to show up like Elon Musk or like Tony Stark right now. You got to kind of chill out and hand it over to developers when it comes to Google I/O. Now I just had the idea of Pichai doing it in my head.
Yeah, so get it out of your head now. But it's something we haven't really talked much about is like their smart home stuff too, because the other leaks that we had was this a couple months ago. If you were on Google's website, they had a little animation of a smart home, and in one of the captions or a couple of the captions, they had a product they had never announced called a Nest Hub Max, which looks like kind of like a one of those Google Home
hubs.
But with a Nest security camera built in.
Home hub is the one with the screen.
Yes.
Yes, yes. So that could be interesting.
With a screen, but no camera. Yeah.
But no camera, and this would have both. But it would be interesting for a couple reasons. One, because it would be with Nest, and they've had an interesting relationship over the last 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
And then there's also the aspect that as we see more and more of Apple getting into the market with smart home stuff, but also Amazon, you know, this would be a way to develop their platform. They don't really have that cohesiveness like Alexa does and Apple does with their smart home, the way they connect apps, the way they connect to stuff like Siri and stuff like that. Obviously, Google Assistant's fantastic, but are they going to have like a background that's going to make it easier to put different products together in your home and connect them all together through Google?
Let's do a little quick history lesson about Nest. Nest was an independent company bought by Google. Then Google reorganized to become Alphabet, spun Nest out as a separate company. So it was a sister company.
And they
did
the thermostat.
They did the thermostat, and that was, I believe, Tony Fadell from the iPod days of Apple. So they were two separate companies under the umbrella of Alphabet. Then, recently, Nest got brought back into Google, which is now under Alphabet. So now you have these two hardware
teams. We need a diagram.
This is actually... Yes.
It was on their website.
If I had a whiteboard, I'd show you. And so now that they're together, Google has two smart home brands. They have Google Home Hubs and Maxes and all this other stuff. And then there's the Nest stuff. So to have two different brands under the same company sounds a little bit confusing, because if they're doing the same thing and they don't have the same features, that's not good. There's also the Nest Secure, when it got Google Assistant capabilities and nobody knew it had a microphone in it, because that wasn't one of the listed objects, one of the features about it, which was really annoying to a lot of people, not knowing that there was a microphone on there. Google was very clear about this. They said, hey, look, that mic wasn't on. You have to opt into it. So be cool now. But people didn't like that response.
Well, get this, Iyaz. This Nest, Nest Hub Max, if it is a real product, it probably does have a microphone, because one of the features it might have is call support for Duo. Who uses Duo?
Nobody.
Nobody uses? Okay. No. But if you did, you could use the microphone that's built in to make Duo phone calls.
Anybody? Any takers? I mean, the issue with privacy is still going to be big. I think Nest definitely has the user base in terms of home. I mean, the Nest camera and, as you mentioned, the Nest thermostat, I think has higher brand recognition in the home than the Google Home Hub outside of, you know, what
tech
it
cultures,
outside of tech culture. And I think it would behoove them to continue keeping the Nest brand, but if they were to find a way to seamlessly integrate it, like what you're talking about right now, Patrick, I think it would, you know, it would kind of start this melding of the two brands and potentially help them out in the smart home realm as they compete with the Amazon Echo Show and, you know, all these other smart home devices that are hitting the market. But I definitely still think that privacy is going to be a huge issue. And I'm really curious to see how they approach this if they do launch an Echo Show type device, and how they, you know, what they say about the camera and having a microphone and a camera in your home all the time. I mean, we're already used to that, but
well, and also I'm wondering,
they still haven't tackled the issue yet, I think.
There was like that Facebook portal thing that came out maybe like, not even a year ago, maybe like 6 months ago, where it was a dedicated like monitor that you could do messaging.
It's a video phone.
Yeah, essentially a video phone. And to be honest, the hardware looked really cool, but the downside was it was made by Facebook, who does not have the best of record with privacy, which we'll get past the privacy joke at F8 last week. But I'm wondering if you have this Nest Hub Max thing that does have something like that, so you can do those phone calls with friends and family. But again, the important thing besides the hardware here is how do they, again, tie all these products together? Is this going to be like that first step, or is it just going to still be a one highway next to an interstate kind of thing going on, where they're going the same direction, but we got to merge them together at some
making
point.
Them cohesive is very important, because if you're buying all these things and you're buying into an ecosystem, you want to make sure that everything's talking to each other. You don't want to find out that product A isn't compatible with product B and they're owned by the same company. That's a nightmare. And then you have these kinds of things of moving on to third parties. And Google used to have Android Things. I think they changed the name of that. So there's all kinds of ways that Google's trying to get everybody on their smart home side obviously Amazon had a huge jump with this, and they did a great job with this. Apple's got a thing, so I'm going to leave that at that. I'm looking at Twitter with the hashtag CNET Live. A fellow here says that Q stands for Quest. I don't know if you guys have Quest bars.
Yes.
I like Quest bars.
Yeah. That's a great
That's a good one, too.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
That's a really good one.
Quest bars, by the way, is like a protein, low carb, high protein bars. They're actually pretty good.
And that would make sense.
They come in like cookie dough and other fun
flavors. If you've
had
like years and years of candy, you were going to want a high protein bar to kind of maybe work off some of that sugar. So.
Right, exactly.
It's sweet, but not sugar.
Not sugar.
I still, you know, I think Lexi was onto something, though. Just with a quick,
yeah. I can imagine Nestle like rebranding Nesquik just
yeah, exactly.
for the 2 years.
Just...
Does that mean would their little animation be? Because usually it's like
the bunny.
Would they have the bunny or would it just be like chocolate powder?
Well, as he leaves, there's chocolate powder behind him, like a trail.
It would look. We should move on from there.
Another
a big pile of chocolate powder as a statue in the Google campus.
Android Quick is for kids.
Another person on Twitter says.
That's tricks, by the way. Yeah.
I know. I was trying to reach it. It didn't. I was
Get
trying
your
to.
Kids' food right.
Yes, exactly.
Again, guys, if you want to tweet us, use the hashtag CNET Live. Tamim says, do you think that 4 gigabytes of RAM is enough for 2019? I mean, my Pixel 3 XL sometimes lags playing PUBG. What do you think? Every Pixel, by the way, since the beginning, Pixel 1, 2, and the XLs, and the 3, all have had 4 gigabytes of RAM. They've never updated that. Do you think, Patrick, that's enough for now?
Short answer, no. But long answer would be like, yes, it just depends. If I'm playing PUBG, no, it's not. And you're going to want, but you're probably you're gonna want to get one of those phones that are more aimed at gaming that have higher RAM, better cooling, where the processor has even a faster processing speed. But I think it would be interesting if they did come out with a Pixel 4 or something like that in the fall. It would have to have maybe they'd have like a 4 gigabytes of RAM base model and get 6 or 8 if when you upgrade the storage or something like that. Because if you look at like some of their competitors, like OnePlus, they're doing huge amounts of RAM and really fast processor speeds. And they cost less than the Pixel, so. Yeah, but their cameras are like a B+ to the A+ of the Pixel. I don't know. But if I want an affordable, easy phone, and I want a sweet, like clean version of Android on it, and it came in between $400 and $500, I would be okay with 4 gigabytes of RAM at that price point.
Yeah, I think that was one of the complaints about the Pixel 3 and the 3 XL. They raised the prices. They didn't upgrade the internals when it came to RAM, which was very surprising because they raised the prices and they had this very weird design for the 3 XL, another thing that made it kind of polarizing, to say the least. So
I would say this, though. I think 4 gigabytes of RAM will be kind of like this year going into next year's like 16 gigabytes of storage was, where it's like that's just too little storage for so long, and like Apple and a lot of manufacturers, that would be their base model. I think we're going to start seeing that with RAM, though, but especially as people want to play games on it.
Mm-hmm. And all the AR features. And I think, like, as you mentioned, in their flagship device going forward, no, I don't think that's enough. However, on these models, the 3A, I think it is just because it's targeting a different type of audience that may not be as interested in, you know, the 4K screen and, you know, the dual camera on the front. They just want the best features, or, you know, the biggest features from the Pixel at a much lower price point. And I think if the rumors are true and the leaks turn out to be true, they would be positioning themselves well, considering that the iPhone XR and the Galaxy S10e are still going to be slightly higher than this Pixel phone would be. So it would actually... It's a mid-tier, but a true mid-tier. Not this, like, mid-tier high-end that these companies have been launching over the last
no,
2 years.
No, it literally is. There's a hole between, like, a $300 and $400 and $500 phone. Mm-hmm. And, like, you have the bottom where you have, like, these budget phones, like, these great Motorola phones, at least in the U.S. Now, mm-hmm. abroad, there are so, like, Huawei has some great ones. But here in the U.S., probably, like, the best bet on that right now is Motorola, right? But then you got to go up to like
five. The iPhone SE.
Okay. Yeah, right. Rest in peace, that. I mean, there's right. an opportunity for Apple there. But then if Google's coming in and filling in that hole, mm-hmm. and you know that as soon as they get released, they're going to get discounted at some point mm-hmm. too, right? So it'll only be a matter of months before that price drops below. And I'm hoping it's close to $400. If it's $500, I think it's pushing it. Don't you guys? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, at least
especially
for the base
model. And for a plastic phone as well, because this is another rumor that
composite.
It's not going to...
It's composite, I believe.
Wait a second. We don't know what it is yet.
Let's, we don't know what it is.
Can we talk about the leaks, the amount of leaks we've seen about the Pixel?
We're already talking about this as, it's, as, know, but like, as it's, if it's real, right?
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Last year, we had the Pixel 3. There were video reviews of it. So this is one better, because we haven't seen video of the 3A or 3AXL. But... Best Buy had the device in Ohio for sale on store shelves already. Vanessa, what do you think about this incredible lack of security? Do you actually want to know everything ahead of time, or do you want it to be out and about?
You know, I think this day and age, nothing is a secret anymore. And I don't think it's exclusive to Google at this point. I mean, it's very unfortunate what happened and how big of a leak this was with the Best Buy incident. But... we've seen this before. We saw this with Samsung. We've seen it even with Apple, who's notoriously secretive about everything, that we know most of the features before they've launched. So I don't think it's...
Okay, so we're going to break in. Sorry, Vanessa, cut you off. Keynote's about to start. We're going to have a post show, so come back. Use the hashtag CNET Live, and we'll be right back. Keep it here, though. The stream is going to happen right here. Watch it.
The only thing we can be sure of about the future is that it will be absolutely fantastic.
We have an opportunity to create the future and decide what that's like.
Can you see better?
Oh, it'll go!
Whatever it is, follow that star, because that's going to keep you going. Keep that flame alive.
Computers recognize patterns, process speech and visual information. Perhaps someday we will really be building intelligent machines.
I don't know why you're laughing at me.
I see this and it feels like nothing short of magic.
Reconsider your vision of the future. Take a chance and be surprised.
Let me plug it in so I can show you a few...
Good morning, good morning. Wonderful to be back here at Shoreline with all of you. It's been a really busy few months for us at Google. We just wrapped up Cloud Next at San Francisco with over 30,000 attendees, as well as YouTube Brandcast last week in New York. Of course, today is about you all, our developer community, and thank you all for joining us in person and to the millions around the world watching on Livestream. I would love to say welcome in all the languages our viewers speak, but we are going to keep the keynote under 2 hours, especially since Barcelona kicks off against Liverpool at noon for you. It should be an amazing game. Every year at I.O., we learn and try to make things a little bit better. That's why we have lots of sunscreen. Hope the sun comes out. Plenty of water and shade. But this year, we want to make it easier for you to get around. So we are using AR to help. To get started, open your I.O. app and choose Explore I.O., and then you can just point your phone where you want to go. We really hope this helps you get around and answers the number one question people have, where the sessions are. Actually, it's not that. They want to know where the food is, and we have plenty of it around. We also have a couple of Easter eggs, and we hope you enjoy them as well. This is a pretty compelling use case, and we actually want to generalize this approach so that you can explore and navigate the whole world that way. There's a lot of hard work ahead, and it's a hard computer science problem, but it's the type of challenge we love. Tackling these kinds of problems is what has kept us going for the past 21 years. And it all begins with our mission to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. And today, our mission feels as relevant as ever. But the way we approach it is constantly evolving. We are moving from a company that helps you find answers to a company that helps you get things done. This morning, we'll introduce you to many products built on a foundation of user trust and privacy, and I'll talk more about that later. We want our products to work harder for you in the context of your job, your home, and your life. And they all share a single goal, to be helpful. So we can be there for you in moments, big and small, over the course of your day. For example, helping you write your emails faster with automatic suggestions from Smart Reply, and giving you the chance to take them back if you didn't get it right the first time. Helping you find the fastest route home at the end of a long day. And when you get there, removing distractions so that you can spend time with the people most important to you. And when you capture those perfect moments, backing them up automatically so you never lose them. Simply put, our goal is to build a more helpful Google for everyone. And when we say helpful, we mean giving you the tools to increase your knowledge, success, health, and happiness. We feel so privileged to be developing products for billions of users. And with that scale comes a deep sense of responsibility to create things that improve people's lives. By focusing on these fundamental attributes, we can empower individuals and benefit society as a whole. Of course, building a more helpful Google for us always starts with search. And the billions of questions users trust Google with every day. But there is so much more we can do to help our users. Last year, we launched a new feature in Google News called Full Coverage, and we have gotten great feedback on it from our users. We'll be bringing Full Coverage directly to search to better organize results for news-related topics. Let's take an example. If you search for black hole, we'll surface the relevant top news. It was in the news recently. We use machine learning to identify different types of stories and give you a complete picture of how a story is being reported from a wide variety of sources. You can click into Full Coverage. It surfaces a breadth of content, but allows you to drill down into what interests you. You can check out different aspects of the story, like how the black hole got its name. You can even now see a timeline of events, and we'll be bringing this to search later this year. Podcasts are another important source of information, and we'll be bringing them directly to search as well. By indexing podcasts, we can surface relevant episodes based on their content, not just the title. And you can tap to listen right in search results, or you can save an episode for listening later on your commute or your Google Home. These are all examples of how we are making search even more helpful for our users, surfacing the right information in the right context. And sometimes, what's most helpful in understanding the world is being able to see it visually. To show you how we are bringing you visual information directly in search, here's Aparna.
Whether you're learning about the solar system or trying to choose a color scheme for your home, seeing is often understanding. With computer vision and augmented reality, the camera in our hands is turning into a powerful visual tool to help you understand the world around you. So today, we are excited to bring the camera to Google Search, adding a new dimension to your search results. Oh, actually, three dimensions, to be precise. So let's take a look. Say you're a student studying human anatomy. Now, when you search for something like muscle flexion, you can view a 3D model built by Visible Body right from the search results. Not only that, pretty cool. Not only that, you can also place it in your own space. Look, it's one thing to read about flexion or extension, But seeing it in action right in front of you while you're studying the concept, very handy. Okay, let's take another example. Say, instead of studying, you're shopping for a new pair of shoes. That happens. With New Balance, you can look at shoes up close from different angles, again, directly from search. That way, you get a much better sense for things like, what does the grip look like on the sole, or how they match with the rest of your clothes. Okay, this last example is a really fun one. So you may have all seen a great white shark in the movies. Jaws, anyone? But what does it actually look like up close? Let's find out, shall we? Okay, I have Archana here with me to help with the demo. So let's go ahead, search for great white shark on Google. As you scroll through, you get information on the knowledge panel, facts, but also see the shark in 3D directly from the knowledge panel. Why don't we go one step further? Why don't we invite the shark to the stage? Whoa! There it is. You know, it's one thing to read a fact, like a great white can be anywhere between 17 feet to 21 feet long. But to see it in front of you at scale, filling up the shoreline stage like a rock star, that is truly understanding its scale. Okay, let's take a closer look. It's an AR shark, it won't bite. Oh, look at those layers of teeth. You know, I don't know about you all, but I'd much rather see these teeth up close in AR than in real life. Thank you, Archana. Really excited about bringing the camera and AR capabilities to Google search. Now, sometimes though, the things that you're interested in, they're difficult to describe in a search box. So that's why we created Google Lens to help you search and do more with what you see by simply pointing your camera. We've built Lens as a capability across products, so you can access it directly from the Google Assistant, but we've also built it into Google Photos and the camera app on many Android devices. People have already used Lens more than a billion times so far, and they've used it to ask questions about what they see, like what kind of flower that is, or where to get a lamp like that, or just who the artist is. One way we've been thinking about it is, with Lens, we're indexing the physical world, billions of places and products and so on, much like search indexes the billions of pages on the web. Okay, today, let me show you some new ways that we're making Lens more helpful to you. Say you're at a restaurant trying to figure out what to order. Instead of going from the menu to different apps on the phone and back to the menu and so on, you can simply point your camera. Lens automatically highlights the popular dish right on the menu. And of course, if you want to know more, you can tap on any dish on the menu, and you can see what it looks like, again, at the restaurant. And of course, check out what other people are saying about it on Google Maps. By the way, when you're done eating, Lens can help pay for your meal. Not so fast, it's not picking up your tab, but it can calculate the tip and even split the total. Again, just by pointing your camera at the receipt, and voila. So you saw how we connected the menu with information from Google Maps. But we're starting to think of other ways that we can connect helpful digital information with the things in the physical world. So I'm going to give you just one example. So you're flipping through a Bon Appetit magazine, and you see a recipe you like. Soon, you can point your camera at the recipe and see the page come alive, showing you how to make the dish. We're starting to work with more partners like museums, magazine publishers, and retailers to bring unique visual experiences like this. There's one final area where we think that the camera can be particularly helpful to people. Around the world, there are more than 800 million adults who are struggling to read the words that they come across in their daily lives, bus schedules, bank forms, etc. And many of them are coming online for the first time with a smartphone. So to help with that, we've integrated a new camera capability into Google Go. This is our search app for entry-level devices. Take this sign in English next to an ATM. Now, for someone who does not understand the language and cannot read the words, this is important information that they're not getting access to. And we think that the camera can help here. So let me show you how. So directly from the Google search bar, you can use Lens, open it, point it at the sign, to hear the text read out aloud to you.
Information for card holders. All customers using old proprietary magnetic stripe cards should be advised.
What is nice here is that it is highlighting the words as they're spoken. That way, even if you can't read the language well, you can follow along and you understand the full context of what you see. You can also translate it into your own language. Like this. Notice that the translated text is overlaid right on top of the original sign. You know, it almost feels like the sign was written in your own language to start with. And again, you can hit listen and hear the words read out loud, this time in your own language.
Información para los titulares de la tarjeta.
What you're seeing here is text-to-speech, computer vision, the power of Translate, and 20 years of language understanding from search, all coming together. Now, our teams in India have been working with some early testers and getting a lot of feedback to make the product better. And I want to now show you how one of them is using it in her daily life. Take a look.
मेरा नाम उर्मिला है ईपी की रहने वाली हूँ मेरे तीन बच्चे हैंगे स्कूल में जाते हैं और बच्चों को होमवर्क नहीं करा सकते हैं लेकिन चलो मेरे बच्चे होशियार हो गए थोड़ा सा नेक पढ़ लिख जाते कोई भी पढ़ा लिखा को काम भाव वो नहीं कर सकते हैं बार बार कहने पड़ती है उन लोगों के कि मतलब थोड़ा सा बता दिए मुझे पहली बार जैसे बच्चों को मतलब बार बार कप्ता नहीं आ रही थी मतलब फोटो लाई
एक कप सोयाबीन बहियों में चार कप पानी डालकर उबालें
तो इसने पढ़ के सुनाया है और जैसे मतलब रिपोर्ट कार्ड आओ बच्चों को
अंग्रेजी हिंदी गणित विज्ञान
तो मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगा कि मतलब वो चीज जा चीज है मतलब जा चीज है अब तो मैं खुद के लिए बहुत कछु काम कर लेंगे
चालू खाता बचत खाता
अब मुझे अब जैसे रेलवे के टिकट कटाना है तो मैं कटा सकती हूँ किसी के सहारा नहीं लेने पड़ता है एक तो इसमें बहुत बेहतर है
Thank you, Urmila, for testing it and giving us a lot of feedback for the team to make the product better. The power to read is the power to buy a train ticket, to shop in a store, to follow the news. It's the power to get things done. So we want to make this feature accessible to as many people as possible. So it already works in more than a dozen languages. And the teams worked incredibly hard to compress all of this tech to just over 100 kilobytes. Wow. That way it can work on phones that cost as little as $35. So we're super excited about this and all the other features across Search and Lens to help you throughout the day. You'll start to see these updates roll out later this month. Thank you.
Thanks, Aparna. Helpfulness is also about saving time and making your day a little bit easier. That's why last year at I/O, we gave you a first look at our Duplex technology. Duplex enables Google Assistant to make restaurant reservations on your behalf by actually placing a call. It's now available in 44 states across the US, and we've gotten great feedback, not only from our users, but from businesses as well. For us, Duplex is the approach by which we train AI on simple but familiar tasks to accomplish them and save you time. Duplex was launched with restaurant reservations on the phone, but now we are moving beyond voice and extending Duplex to tasks on the web. We again want to focus on narrow use cases to start. So we are looking at rental car bookings as well as movie ticketing. Today, when you make a new reservation online, you have to navigate a number of pages and steps, filling out information and making selections along the way. I'm sure you're all familiar with this experience. It's time consuming, and if users leave during the workflow, businesses lose out as well. We want to make this experience better for both users and businesses. So let me show you how the assistant can do it better. Say you get a calendar reminder about an upcoming trip, and you want to book a rental car. You can just ask Google, book a national car rental for my next trip. The assistant opens the national website and automatically starts filling out your information on your behalf, including the dates of the trip. You can confirm the details with just a tap, and then the assistant continues to navigate the site. It even selects which car you like. It's acting on your behalf and helping you save time, but you're always in control of the flow. Let's go ahead and add a car seat. And once all the details are in, you can check everything one last time and just tap to finalize the reservation. You'll immediately get a booking confirmation. It's amazing to see the assistant complete a task online on your behalf in a personalized way. It understands the dates of your trip and your car preferences based on trip confirmations in Gmail. I also want to point out that this was not a custom integration. This required no action on part of the business to implement. What you just saw is an early preview of what we are calling Duplex on the web. We're going to be thoughtful and get feedback from both users and businesses to improve the experience, and we'll have more details later this year. The Google Assistant helps people around the world with all kinds of tasks, whether they are at home or on the go. But we want to build an even more helpful assistant. In order to process speech today, we rely on complex algorithms. It includes multiple machine learning models. One model maps incoming sound bytes into phonetic units. Another one takes and assembles these phonetic units into words. And then a third model predicts the likelihood of these words in a sequence. They are so complex that they require 100 gigabytes of storage and a network connection. Bringing these models to your phone, think of it as putting the power of a Google data center in your pocket. It's an incredibly challenging computer science problem. I'm excited to share we have reached a significant milestone. Further advances in deep learning have allowed us to combine and shrink the 100 gigabyte models down to half a gigabyte, small enough to bring it onto mobile devices. This eliminates network latency and makes the assistant so much faster, so fast, that tapping to use your phone would seem slow. I think this is going to transform the future of the assistant, and I'm thrilled to bring Scott to tell you more about our next generation assistant.
Thanks, Sundar. Well, what if we could bring the AI that powers the assistant right onto your phone? What if the assistant was so fast at processing your voice that tapping to operate your phone would almost seem slow? It opens up many new use cases, and we want to show you how fast it is. Now, internally, we've been calling this the next generation assistant. Running on device, it can process and understand requests in real time and deliver the answers up to 10 times faster. Now, Maggie's here, and she's going to help us test it out, starting with some back-to-back commands to demonstrate its speed. Now, this demo is hot off the press, so please send your positive energy over in Maggie's direction.
Hey, Google. Open calendar. Open calculator. Open photos. Set a timer for 10 minutes. What's the weather today? What about tomorrow? Show me John Legend on Twitter. Get a Lyft ride to my hotel. Turn the flashlight on. Turn it off. Take a selfie.
All right. Now, as you could see, yeah. That's awesome. Maggie was able to open and navigate apps instantly. Now, you might have also noticed that with continued conversation, she was able to make several requests in a row without having to say, "Hey, Google," each time. Now, beyond an effortless way to operate your phone, you can start to imagine how the assistant fused into the device could orchestrate tasks across apps. Let's look at another demo where Maggie's chatting with a friend. He's going to ask her about a recent trip. Notice how easy it is for her to respond with her voice and even share a photo.
Reply, had a great time with my family and it was so beautiful. Show me my photos from Yellowstone. The ones with animals. Send it to Justin.
All right. Yeah. Now, another example is when a friend asks you a question and you need to look up the information to respond. Justin wanted to know when Maggie's flight arrives.
When's my flight? When's my flight? Reply, I should get in around 1 p.m.
All right, so notice how it helped Maggie multitask more easily across different apps, saving her a lot of back and forth. Now, you can even imagine this next generation assistant handling more complex speech scenarios, like composing and sending an email.
Hey, Google, send an email to Jessica. Hi, Jessica. I just got back from Yellowstone and completely fell in love with it. Set subject to Yellowstone Adventures. Let me know if next weekend works for dinner so I can tell you all about it. Send it.
Uh-huh. All right. Now, as you could see, this required the assistant to understand when Maggie was dictating part of the message versus when she was asking it to complete an action. Thanks, Maggie.
Thanks, Scott.
By moving these powerful AI models right onto your phone, we're envisioning a paradigm shift. this next generation assistant will let you instantly operate your phone with your voice, multitask across apps, and complete complex actions, all with nearly zero latency. And actions like turning on the flashlight, opening Gmail, or checking your calendar will even work offline. Now, it's a very hard problem we've been solving, and I'm really excited to share the realization of this vision is not far off. In fact, this next generation assistant is coming to the new Pixel phones later this year. All right. Now, our mission is to make the assistant the best way to get things done. You just saw how we're making it much faster, but it also has to be personal enough to really help you. Now, personalized help is especially important in areas where people's preferences completely differ, like choosing what to listen to, what to do on the weekend, or even what to eat. So let's look at a recipe example. Hey, Google, what should I cook for dinner?
Here are some recipe picks for you.
Now, as you can see, the assistant picked recipes tailored to me. For example, it suggested a bourbon chicken recipe because it's helped me with barbecue recipes in the past. Now, what I really love is that different people get completely different results. We call this feature Picks for You, and it'll be launching on smart displays later this summer, starting with recipes, podcasts, and events. Now, beyond your preferences, becoming more personal means the assistant will better understand the people, places, and events that are important to you. Now, one important person in my life is my mom, who I'm going to visit right after I.O. So let's say I ask my assistant, how's the traffic to mom's house? Now, we all understand what I mean by mom's house, right? Well, if I'm in Toledo, mom's house might have meant this place, a nonprofit childcare center. In other cities, mom's house can be a restaurant or a grocery store. In fact, there's lots of things in the world called mom's house. Now, in linguistics, the process of figuring out which thing a phrase refers to is called reference resolution, and it's fundamental to understanding human language. At Google, we approach this problem using our knowledge graph of things in the world and their relationships. It's what allows us to understand something like the Starbucks near the Golden Gate Bridge. Today, we're expanding the assistant's ability to understand you better by applying those same techniques to the things in your world. We call it personal references. So if I've shared my mom's contact info with the assistant, I can ask, hey Google, what's the weather like at mom's house this weekend?
Friday and Saturday in Carmichael will be partly cloudy.
How long will it take to get there?
With light traffic, it will take you 2 hours and 14 minutes to get to 123 Main Street by car.
Remind me to order flowers a week before mom's birthday.
All right, I'll remind you on July 3rd.
And it goes beyond mom. If you've shared important people, places, and events with the assistant, you'll be able to ask for things more naturally, like show me photos of my son, or directions to the restaurant reservation, or remind me to pick up chocolates on my anniversary. And rest assured, you're always in control. You can edit or delete this information at any time in the updated You tab in Assistant Settings. Now, one place where the assistant can be especially helpful is in the car, offering a safer, hands-free way to get everything you need while you're on the road. Now, we've been focused on the main things that we all want when we're driving, to get where we're going safely, to catch up with friends, and to listen to something interesting along the way. Last year, we brought the assistant to Android Auto, and earlier this year, we added it to navigation in Google Maps. I'm happy to share the assistant is also coming to Waze in the next few weeks. Now, I'd like to show you the future of how we're improving your mobile driving experience even more, introducing the assistant's new driving mode. Just put your phone in the car and say, hey Google, let's drive. Driving mode has a thoughtfully designed dashboard that brings your most relevant activities front and center while you're driving, and includes suggestions personalized for you. For example, if you have a dinner reservation on your calendar, you'll see a convenient shortcut to navigate to the restaurant. Or if you started a podcast at home in the morning, once you get in your car, it'll display a shortcut to resume the episode right where you left off. Now, it also highlights top contacts, making it easy to call them or message them, and recommendations for other things to listen to. Now, once you're navigating, phone calls and music appear in a low-profile way, so you can get things done without leaving your navigation screen. Hey Google, play some jazz.
Sure, check out this jazz music station on YouTube Music.
Now everything is voice enabled, so if a call comes in, the assistant will tell you who's calling and ask if you want to answer without having to take your eyes off the road.
Call from Mom. Do you want to pick it up?
No, thanks. But thanks for your help with the demo, Mom. All right, so best of all, with the assistant already on your phone, there's no need to download an app. Just start driving. Driving mode will be available this summer on any Android phone with the assistant. Yeah, that's good. Now today, the Google Assistant is available on over 1 billion devices in over 30 languages across 80 countries. And with Duplex on the web, the next generation assistant, personalized help, and assistance in the car, we're continuing to build on our mission to be the fastest, most personal way to help you get things done. Now, before I go, I want to share a little something that a lot of you have been asking for. Check this out. Stop. Now you can stop your timers and alarms just by saying stop. No Hey Google needed. And it's rolling out on smart displays and Google Homes in English-speaking locales starting today. Thanks very much.
Hey Google, open the pod bay doors.
Hey Google.
Hey Google.
Hey Google.
Hey Google.
Turn on the lights.
Turn on Sumo.
I love that.
Hey Google.
Call Mom.
I found a few restaurants near you.
Order my usual from Starbucks.
Ordering you a grande vanilla latte from Starbucks.
Love you. I love you.
Okay Google.
This is a cat.
The forecast is 72 and sunny.
Take a selfie.
Hey Google,
what's on my calendar for today?
Make me laugh.
How do I slice a mango?
Turn on the Christmas spirit.
Begin Operation Kevin.
Operation Kevin underway.
Show me how to make an octopus costume on YouTube.
Thanks, Scott. It's great to see the momentum of Google Assistant and how it's able to help users get things done. So far, we've talked about building a more helpful Google. It's equally important to us that we do this for everyone. For everyone is a core philosophy for us at Google. That's why, from the earliest days, search works the same, whether you're a professor at Stanford or a student in rural Indonesia. It's why we build affordable laptops for classrooms everywhere. And it's why we care about the experience on low-cost phones in countries where users are just starting to come online with the same passion as we do with premium phones. And it goes beyond our products and services. It's why we offer free training and tools through Grow with Google, helping people grow their skills, find jobs, and build their businesses. And it's how we develop our technology, ensuring the responsible development of AI, privacy and security that works for everyone, and products that are accessible at their core. Let's start with building AI for everyone. Bias has been a concern in science long before machine learning came along. But the stakes are clearly higher with AI. It's not enough to know if a model works. We need to know how it works. We want to ensure that our AI models don't reinforce bias that exists in the real world. It's a hard problem, which is why we are doing fundamental computer science research to improve the transparency of machine learning models and reduce bias. Let me show you what I mean. When computer scientists deploy machine learning models, it can sometimes be difficult to understand why they make a certain prediction. That's because most machine learning models appear to operate on low-level features. Edges and lines in a picture, color of a single pixel. That's very different than the higher-level concepts more familiar to humans, like stripes on a zebra. To tackle this problem, Google AI researchers are working on a new methodology called TCAV, or testing with concept activation vectors. Let me give you an example. If it's a machine learning model trained to detect zebras, you would want to know which variables were being used to decide if the image contained a zebra or not. TCAV can help you understand if the concept of stripes was important to the model's prediction. In this particular case, it makes sense. Stripes are an important predictor for the model. Now suppose a classifier was trained on pictures of doctors. If the training data was mostly males wearing coats and stethoscopes, then the model could inaccurately assume that being male was an important prediction factor. There are other important examples as well. Now imagine an AI system that could help with detecting skin cancer. To be effective, it would need to recognize a wide variety of skin tones representative of the entire population. There's a lot more to do, but we are committed to building AI in a way that's fair and works for everyone, including identifying and addressing bias in our own ML models and sharing tools and open data sets to help you as well. Another way we build for everyone is by ensuring that our products are safe and private, and that people have clear, meaningful choices around their data. We strongly believe that privacy and security are for everyone, not just a few. This is why powerful privacy features and controls have always been built into Google services. We launched incognito mode in Chrome over a decade ago. We pioneered Google Takeout, which gives you easy controls to export your data from email, contacts, photos, all of our products, anytime you choose to. But we know our work on privacy and security is never done. And we want to do more to stay ahead of constantly evolving user expectations. We've been working on a significant set of enhancements, and I want to talk you through a few. Today, you can already find all your privacy and security settings in one place in your Google account. To make sure your Google account is always at your fingertips, we are making it easily accessible from your profile photo. If you're in search, you can tap on your photo and you can quickly access the most relevant privacy controls for search in case your data in search. Here, you can view and manage your recent activity, and you can easily change your privacy settings. Last week, we announced auto-delete controls, which you'll also be able to access right from the app. Data helps make search work better for you. And with auto-delete, you can choose how long you want it to be saved. For example, 3 or 18 months, after which any old data will be automatically and continuously deleted from your account. This is launching today for web and app activity. We'll be rolling it out to location history in the coming weeks, and we'll continue to bring features such as this to more controls over time. In addition, one-tap access to your Google account will be coming to our major products, including Chrome, Search, Assistant, YouTube, Google News, and Maps. And speaking of Maps, if you tap on your profile photo, in addition to finding easy access to your privacy controls, you'll find a new feature, incognito mode. Incognito mode has been a popular feature in Chrome since it launched, and we are bringing this to Maps. While in incognito in Maps, your activity, like the places you search and navigate to, won't be linked to your account. We want to make it easy to enter in and out of incognito, and Maps will soon join Chrome and YouTube with support for incognito, and we'll be bringing it to search as well this year. Another way we ensure your privacy is by working hard to keep your data secure. From safe browsing, which now protects over 4 billion devices every day, to using TensorFlow to significantly reduce phishing attacks in Gmail, we also encourage users to use two-step verification, because an additional layer of protection is always helpful. Today, we are making two-step verification even more convenient for everyone by bringing the protection of security keys directly into your Android phone. So now you can confirm a sign-in with just a tap. And today, it'll be available to over 1 billion compatible devices. We always want to do more for users, but do it with less data over time. So we are applying the same cutting-edge AI research that makes our products better and applying it to enhance user privacy. Federated learning, this is a new approach to machine learning developed by Google, is one example. It allows Google's AI products to work better for you and work better for everyone without collecting raw data from your devices. Instead of sending data to the cloud, we flip the model. We ship machine learning models directly to your device. Each phone computes an update to the global model, and only those updates, not the data, is securely uploaded and aggregated in large batches to improve the global model. And then the updated global model is sent back to everyone's device. Let me explain it with a concrete example. Take Gboard, Google's keyboard. Using on-device learning alone, when new words become popular, Gboard would not be able to suggest them until you've typed them many times. Federated learning, however, allows Gboard to learn new words, like BTS or YOLO, after thousands of people start using them without Google ever seeing anything you type. Actually, with BTS, it's probably millions of people. This is not just research. In fact, Gboard is already using federated learning to improve next word prediction, as well as emoji prediction, across tens of millions of devices. It's still very early, but we are excited about the progress and the potential of federated learning across many more of our products. Privacy and security are the foundation for all the work we do, and we'll continue to push the boundaries of technology to make it even better for our users. Building for everyone also means ensuring that everyone can access our products. The World Health Organization estimates that 15% of the world's population, over 1 billion people, has a disability. We believe technology can help us be more inclusive, and AI is providing us with new tools to dramatically improve experience for people with disabilities. For example, there are almost 500 million people in the world who are deaf or hard of hearing. Think of how many conversations are challenging, from in-person discussions and phone calls to even experiencing videos online. A few months ago, we launched Live Transcribe, powered by Google's Cloud Speech API, to caption conversations in real time. You can leave your phone open with the app, and when someone speaks to you, it transcribes their speech into text. Those who cannot or prefer not to speak can also respond by typing. I was really inspired by how the product came about. Two of our Google researchers, Dimitri and Chet, saw an opportunity to help people and collaborated to develop the app. Together with a small team of engineers and people who volunteered their 20% time, they built Live Transcribe, and it is now available in over 70 languages and dialects on Android devices. Today, we are going further and extending this technology. We are announcing a new feature called Live Caption. Live Caption makes all content, no matter its origin, more accessible to everyone. The incredible thing is that it works completely on device, so there's no delay. With one click, you can turn on captions for a web video, podcast, or even on a moment you capture at home.
You like the blueberries?
The
blueberries? Delicious? Here comes more. So there you are.
This is it's only possible due to our recent breakthroughs in speech recognition technology. We recently tested live caption with some users. Let's take a look.
So if you hit this volume button here, and then we turn on that button, and you can even, if you want to see more, you can.
Oh my God.
This is really amazing.
It feels like, wow, it's such a simple feature, but it has such an impact on me.
It's going to make our lives so much easier. I wake up 2 o'clock in the morning to walk to wake up my mom or dad to say, what are they saying on this?
You can imagine all the use cases for the broader community too. For example, the ability to watch any video if you're in a meeting or on the subway without disturbing the people around you. The Android team is going to talk a little bit later today about what made live caption possible. We are also exploring how this technology can caption phone calls, but we want to go one step further and actually allow more people to respond and accomplish tasks over their phones. As you'll see in this example, Nicole, who is deaf and prefers not to speak, can receive a call from her hairstylist. With Smart Compose and Smart Reply, she can answer the call and interact. Let's take a look.
Hi, this is Nicole's assistive chat. She'll see what you say, and her responses will be read back to you, starting now.
Hi, Nicole, it's Jamie. How are you?
Hey, Jamie. I'm good, and you?
Great. Are we still on for your 1 p.m. haircut tomorrow?
Sorry, can you do 3 p.m.?
Yes, I can do 3 p.m. We have a lot to catch up on. I want to hear all about your trip.
Perfect. Thumbs up.
Great. See you tomorrow. Bye.
Thumbs up indeed. We call this new technology Live Relay. While there's still more work to do, we are excited to see how it can help people like Nicole get things done more easily. Just like with live caption, this runs completely on device, and these conversations remain private to you. We also want to help those with speech disorders or people whose speech has been affected by a stroke or ALS. Researchers from Google AI are exploring the idea of personalized communication models that can better understand different types of speech, as well as how AI can help even those who cannot speak to communicate. We call this research Project Euphonia. Let's take a look.
Google has very good general speech recognition, but if you do not sound as most of people, it will not understand you.
No one's ever collected large data sets of people whose speech is hard for others to understand.
People who have multiple sclerosis for GF, who had stroke, who stutter.
They're not used in training the speech recognition models. I mean, the game is to record things.
What's the temperature today?
And then have it recognize things that you say that aren't in the training set. Dimitri recorded 15,000 phrases. It wasn't obvious that this was going to work. He just sat there and he kept recording.
We need to make all voice interactive devices be able to understand any person who speaks to them.
You can see that it's possible to make a speech recognizer to work for Dimitri, it should be possible to make it work for many people, even people who can't speak because they've lost the ability to speak. The work that Shenxing has done on, you know, voice utterances, from sounds alone, you can communicate. But there might be other ways of communicating.
Most people with ALS end up using an on-screen keyboard and having to type each individual letter with their eyes. For me, communicating is slow.
Steve might crack a joke, and it's related to something that happened, you know, a few minutes ago. The idea is to create a tool so that Steve can train machine learning models himself to understand his facial expressions. To be able to laugh, to be able to cheer, to be able to boo. Things that seem maybe superfluous, but actually are so core to being human.
I still think this is only the tip of the iceberg. We're not even scratching the surface yet of what is possible. If we can get speech recognizers to work with small numbers of people, we'll learn lessons which we can then combine to build something that really works for everyone.
To understand and be understood is absolutely unbelievable.
We are working hard to provide these voice recognition models through the Google Assistant in the future. But as you saw in Dimitri's case, this will only be possible with many more speech samples to train our models on. If you or someone you know has slurred or hard to understand speech, we'd like to invite you to submit voice samples to help accelerate this effort. Fundamental AI research, which enables new products for people with disabilities, is an important way we drive our mission forward. Live Transcribe, Live Caption, Live Relay, and Project Euphonia will ultimately result in products that work better for all of us. It's a perfect example of what we mean by building a more helpful Google for everyone. One of the most powerful ways we deliver help to our users is through our open source platforms like Android. To tell you more, I'd like to invite Steph onto the stage.
It's amazing we're here to talk about Android's version 10. And we get to celebrate a milestone together. Today, there are over 2.5 billion active Android devices. And today, we want to walk you through what's coming next in Android Q. Innovation, security and privacy, the central theme of the Q release, and digital well-being. A lot has changed since 1.0. Smartphones have evolved from an early vision to this integral tool in our lives. And they are incredibly helpful. Looking ahead, we see another big wave of innovation coming to make them even more helpful. Q shows Android shaping the leading edge of mobile innovation, with over 180 device makers around the world. Driven by this powerful ecosystem, many innovations have been first on Android, from large screens to the first OLED display. And this year, display technology will take an even bigger leap, with foldables coming from multiple Android OEMs. These devices open up a completely new category, which, though early, just might change the future of mobile computing. Foldables take advantage of a completely new display technology. They literally bend and fold from phone to tablet-sized screen. And Q maximizes what's possible on these screens. For instance, foldables are great for multitasking. So I can watch some funny videos my sister sent me while we chat about what we're going to do for my mom on Mother's Day. But the feature I'm most excited about is screen continuity. So let's say we finish chatting. It's time to head out, and I'm standing around waiting for my ride. So I start playing a game on the folded, smaller screen. When I sit down and unfold, the game seamlessly transfers to the larger screen. It is so cool. And I can pick up exactly where I was playing. Now, multiple OEMs will launch foldables this year, all running Android. Another exciting innovation is 5G. 5G networks mean consistently faster speeds with lower latency. So apps, and especially games, can target rich, immersive experiences to these 5G connected phones. And Android Q supports 5G natively. This year, more than 20 carriers will launch networks. And our OEMs have over a dozen 5G-ready phones all launching this year, and they'll all be running Android. Now, in addition to hardware innovation, we're also seeing huge firsts in software, driven by advances in on-device machine learning. Sundar showed live caption. Now, I would really like you to see it in action and then take you under the hood. Please welcome Tristan.
Like many people, I watch videos without sound when I'm on the go. With captions, I can still keep up, even if I'm in a crowded space or I'm sitting in a meeting. So for me, they're super helpful. But for the almost 500 million people who are deaf or hard of hearing, captions are critical. Today, loads of mobile content embeds audio, from video to voice messages and everything in between. Without captions, this content is nowhere near as accessible. Live Caption in Q takes audio and instantly turns it into text. Let's take a look at this video my friend Heather sent me yesterday. To turn it on, I open the volume rocker and tap the Live Caption button.
Hey, cutie. Do you want to give your puppy a hug? Oh, I guess not. Puppy is walking away.
So as you can see, these captions appear in real time over a video that would normally never have captions. You can expand them, contract them, move them up and down. It's a lot of fun. But what makes this feature so incredible is that it's entirely done on device. In fact, it doesn't need to be connected to the internet at all. If we take a look, this entire demo I've done in airplane mode. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin. Okay. So how is this possible? It's because of a huge breakthrough in speech recognition that we made earlier this year. This once required streaming audio to the cloud to run a 2 gigabyte model for processing. Now we can do that same processing on device using a recurrent neural net in just 80 megabytes. The live speech model is running on the phone, and no audio stream ever leaves it. All this protects user privacy. And this is OS-wide, which means you get those captions in all your apps and in web content, too. Now, the same on-device machine learning powers another useful Q feature, which is Smart Reply. With Smart Reply, the OS helpfully suggests what you'll type next. It'll predict the text you'll type, even emoji. And it's a huge time saver. What's really cool is this works now for all messaging apps in Android. Like in Signal, you can see the OS providing these helpful suggestions. And Smart Reply can now even predict the actions that you'll take. So say a friend sends you an address. And normally, you'd copy and paste that into Maps. That's kind of a hassle. With Smart Reply, you just tap, and it will open for you. And all this is saving you time. On-device machine learning powers everything from these incredible breakthroughs like Live Caption to helpful everyday features like Smart Reply. And it does this with no user input ever leaving the phone, all of which protects user privacy. Now, there's one more addition to Android Q that's small, but you've been asking us about for a while, and that is Dark Theme. And we're launching it in Q. So you can activate it by using the Quick Tile or by turning on Battery Saver. And in fact, it will help you save battery. Your OLED display is one of the most power-hungry components in your phone. So by lighting up less pixels, we'll save you battery. So that's innovation. But we feel all innovation must happen within a frame of security and privacy. People now carry phones constantly, and we trust them with a lot of personal information. You should always be in control of what you share and who you share it with. And that's why the second area we'll cover and the central focus of the release is security and privacy. Now, over the years, Android's built out a huge set of protections already. File-based encryption, SSL by default, secure DNS, work profiles. And many of these were first on Android. Android has the most widely deployed security and anti-malware service of any OS, with Google Play Protect. It runs on every device, and it scans over 50 billion apps a day. In fact, in Gartner's 2019 security report, which was published this week, Android scored the highest possible rating in 26 out of 30 categories. It's ahead on multiple points, from authentication to network security to malware protection and more. At the same time, we wanted to go much further. And that's why Android Q includes almost 50 features focused on security and privacy, all providing more protection, transparency, and control. So first, in Q, we've brought privacy to the top level in settings. And there, you'll find a number of important controls all in one place. Activity data, location history, ad settings, and you decide what's on or off. Now, location is another place we've created tools for more transparency and control. Now, location can be really helpful, especially when you're lost in a new place. But it's also some of your most personal information, and you should, again, always be in control of who you share it with and how they can use it. So first, if you're wondering which apps can be accessing your location, we make it easy for you to know. With Q, your device will give you helpful reminders whenever an app accesses location when you're not actively using that app. So you can review and decide, do you want to continue sharing or not? Second, Q will give you more control over how you share location data with apps. For example, say you want to get pizza delivered. You can choose to share your location only while the app is in use. And as soon as you close, you'll stop sharing location. Finally, what if you're wondering, what kind of location do all my apps have? In Q, we've brought location controls to the forefront in settings, so you can quickly review every app and change location access with simple controls. Now, there are many, many more enhancements to security and privacy throughout the OS, like TLS v3, encryption for low-end devices, randomizing your MAC address by default, and many more. And you can read about all of these in our blog post this week. But there's one more really big thing for security. Now, your Android device gets regular security updates already, but you still have to wait for the release, and you have to reboot when they come. We want you to get these faster, even faster. And that's why in Q, we're making a set of OS modules updatable directly over the air. So now these can be updated individually as soon as they are available and without a reboot of the device. Now, this was a huge technical challenge. We're updating these in the background the same way we're updating Google Apps. It's easier for our partners with whom we're working closely, but more importantly, it's much better for you. You can learn more about this at the session, What's New in Android? Now, there's one more thing that's changed since the early days of Android. Now, people carry smartphones everywhere because they're really helpful. But we're also spending a lot of time on phones. And people tell us sometimes they wish they'd spent more time on other things. We want to help people find balance and digital well-being. And yes, sometimes this means making it easier to put your device away entirely and focus on the times that really matter. That's why last year, we launched digital well-being tools with dashboards, app timers, flip to shush, and wind down to help you set the phone down and get to sleep at night. And these tools are really helping. App timers helped users stick to their goals over 90% of the time. And users of wind down had a 27% drop in nighttime usage. If you're not using these already, I would really recommend them. But this year, we want to help even more with distraction. A lot of times, I just want to sit down and focus to get something done. And when I'm trying to do this, like working, maybe it's studying for you, I don't want email or anything else to distract me. And that's why we've created a new mode for Android. It's called Focus Mode. When I enter Focus Mode, I can select the apps that I find distracting. For me, that's email, the news. So now they're turned off, and I can really get to work. Those apps that distract me are disabled. But I can still keep texts because it's important to me that my family can always get a hold of me. Until I come out of Focus Mode, and then everything is back. Focus Mode is coming to devices on P and Q this fall. Now, finally, I want to talk about families. For 84% of us parents, technology use by our kids is a top concern. In the US, the average age of kids getting phones is now 8. In Q, Family Link parental controls will be built right into the settings of the device. So when you set up a device for someone in your family, Family Link will help connect it to a parent. And you can review any apps that your child wants to install. After that, you can set daily screen time limits. You can check, where are the apps where my kids are spending time? And you can set a device bedtime so your kids can disconnect and get to sleep. And now in Android Q, you can set time limits on specific apps. And when your child hits that device bedtime, if you want to give them just 5 more minutes, now we have bonus time. Now, there's a ton more in Q that we don't have time to cover, a ton. Everything from streaming media to hearing aids to better connectivity to new gesture UI and more. So today, I'm excited to announce that Q Beta 3 is available on 21 devices. That is 12 OEMs plus all Pixels. And that is more than double last year. We hope you head over to the link to get it on your phone because we would love to have you try it out. And now I will hand it over to Rick. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Steph. Well, we've heard about some terrific innovations today in Android, AI, and the Assistant, and real breakthroughs in how we're able to help our users. I'd like to spend a few minutes and talk about how some of those come to life in our Made by Google products. Now, we continue to believe that the biggest breakthroughs are happening at the intersection of AI, software, and hardware. Whether that's a tensor processing unit, an entire data center, the phone in your hand, or a helpful smart display in your home. Let's start there. The smart home of today is frustrating. To deliver real help in the home, you can't start with technology. You have to start with people. And we've always worked to put people first and build technology around their needs. There's no more important place to get this right than in the home. Let's take a look.
Hold on to me.
No, sweetie.
Create volume and drama in it.
As we roll down this unfamiliar road. Follow this wave, stream us along. Just know you're not alone. Cause I wanna make this place your home. The trouble in my drag you down. You get lost, you can always be found. Just know you're not alone. I'm gonna make this place your home.
Your home is the most special place in your life, so we need to be thoughtful about the technology we create for it. By putting people first, we're going beyond the idea of a smart home to create a truly helpful home. Over the past year, we've brought the Nest and Google teams together to deliver on our vision of the helpful home. And today, we're further simplifying things, bringing all of these products together under the Nest name. As a single team and a single product family, we're following a set of guiding principles that reflect our commitment to putting people first. Now, to start, we believe technology should be easy for everyone in the home to use, whether they're 5 or 95. The helpful home should also be personal for everyone. With Google Assistant at the core, we can provide a personalized experience for the entire household, even in communal spaces. And the tech in your home should work together for a single, seamless experience across rooms and devices. Most importantly, the helpful home needs to respect your privacy. And today, we're publishing privacy commitments for our home products that clearly explain how they work, the data we're storing, and how it's used. Our vision for the helpful home is anchored in the Assistant. And as you heard from Scott, we're continuing to get more helpful over time. We want to make sure that you can get the help you need where you need it. Google Home Hub, which we're renaming Nest Hub, was designed specifically to bring the helpfulness of the assistant to any room in your house. Now, we've also been working on a new display that builds on the things that people love about Hub, but is designed for communal spaces in the home where the family gathers. Introducing Nest Hub Max. It's a new product that has a camera and a larger 10-inch display, which is perfect for the center of your helpful home. Hub Max pulls together your connected devices together into a home view dashboard, where you can see your Nest cams, you can switch on lights, control your music, and adjust your thermostat. Hub Max also supports Thread. So just like Nest Connect, it communicates directly with Thread-supported devices that need a low-power connection, like door locks or motion sensors. And we've designed Hub Max with an incredibly helpful camera. If you want to know what's going on in your home, you can choose to use it like a Nest Cam. You can turn it on when you're away from home. You can check on things right from the Nest app in your phone. And just like a Nest Cam, it's easy to see your event history, enable Home and Away Assist, and you also get a notification if the camera detects any motion or sees someone it doesn't recognize in your home. Now, video calling is easy too with Google Duo. The camera has a wide-angle lens, and it automatically adjusts to keep you centered in the frame. You can chat with any iOS or Android device, or a PC with a Chrome browser. You can also use Duo to leave video messages for members of your household. Hub Max is designed to give you full control over the camera. Nothing is streamed or recorded unless you intentionally enable it. And you'll always know when the camera's on with a green indicator light. You have multiple controls to disable camera features, and a physical switch on the back electrically disconnects the camera and the microphones. And you can see all these controls clearly on the display. Hub Max, thank you. Hub Max is designed to be used by multiple people in your home and provide everyone with the help they need in a personalized way. Now, to help with that, we've offered users the choice to enable voice match so the assistant can recognize your voice and respond directly to you. But today, we're also extending the options to personalize using the camera with a feature we call face match. For each person in your family that chooses to turn it on, the assistant guides you through a process of creating a face model, which is then encrypted and stored on the device. Then, whenever you walk in front of the camera, Hub Max recognizes you and shows just your information and not anyone else's. Face Match's facial recognition technology is processed locally on the device using on-device machine learning, so the camera data never leaves the device. And in the morning, I can walk into the kitchen, and the assistant knows to greet me with my calendar, my commuting details, the weather, and any other information I need to start my day. And when I get home, Hub Max welcomes me home with any reminders that might be waiting for me. And the assistant offers personalized recommendations for music and TV shows, and I can even see if anyone's left me a video message. One of my favorite things about Hub Max is that it's a great digital photo frame. No matter what kind of day I'm having, nothing makes me feel better than seeing some of my favorite memories on this beautiful screen. And the Google Photos integration makes this whole process really simple. I can select my family and friends, and Hub Max displays the best photos of them from years ago or from earlier today. And now, with a simple voice command, sharing my favorite shots is easier than ever. The big screen also makes Hub Max the kitchen TV you've always wanted. Tell it what you want to watch, or if you need help deciding, just ask the assistant to pull up our new on-screen guide. Hub Max can stream your favorite live shows and sports on YouTube TV. But unlike your kitchen TV, it can also teach you how to cook, see who's at the front door, and play your music. You're also getting full stereo sound with a powerful rear-facing woofer. And now when the volume's up, instead of yelling at the assistant to turn it down or pause the game, with the camera, it's as simple as a gesture. You just raise your hand. And Hub Max uses on-device machine learning to instantly identify your gesture and pause your media. Hub Max is a Google Assistant smart display that's also a smart home controller, a TV for your kitchen, a great digital photo frame, an indoor camera, and it's perfect for video calling. All this will be available on Nest Hub Max later this summer for just $229. And today, we're lowering the price of the original Nest Hub from $149 to $129. And we're expanding its availability to 12 new markets and supporting 9 new languages. So whether you prefer a hub with a camera or without one, we have a device that'll help you in your home. As I said earlier, there's a fundamental difference between a smart home and a helpful home. And we're excited to unify all our products under the Nest brand to make the helpful home more real for more people. All right, next I want to talk about Pixel. And our, thank you. And I love talking about Pixel. I want to talk about our work to bring a more helpful smartphone experience to more people. A core element of Google's mission is to make technology more available and accessible for everyone. And Sundar said it earlier, we need to ensure that technology benefits the many, not just the few. But there's been a really troubling trend in the smartphone industry. To support the latest technologies, everyone's high-end phones are getting more and more expensive. So we challenged ourselves to see if we could optimize our software and AI to work great on more affordable hardware, so we can deliver these high-end experiences at a more accessible price point. I want to introduce you to the newest members of the Pixel family, Google Pixel 3a and 3a XL, designed to deliver premium features at a price people will love. We didn't compromise on the capabilities and performance you'd expect from a premium device, which is why we branded them Pixel. They start at just $399. It's about half the price of typical flagship phones. And I want to introduce Sabrina to tell you more about how we did it.
Thanks, Rick. Delivering premium features with high performance on a phone at this price point, it's been a huge engineering challenge, and I'm really proud of what our team has been able to accomplish with Pixel 3a. So let's start with the design. Pixel 3a follows the design language of the Pixel family, the familiar two-tone look, smooth finish, and ergonomic unibody design. It feels good in your hand, and it looks beautiful. Pixel 3a comes in 3 colors, just black, clearly white, and a new color, purple-ish. Everything looks amazing on the vibrant OLED display, and your music, your podcasts, they sound great in premium stereo. Pixel 3a supports Bluetooth 5.0 and USB-C digital audio, and we've also included a 3.5-millimeter audio jack. Because we've heard some people want more headphone options. But what Pixel is really known for is its incredible camera. And with software optimizations, we found a way to bring our exclusive camera features and our industry-leading image quality into Pixel 3a. So photos look stunning in any light. What other smartphone cameras try to do with expensive hardware, we can deliver with software and AI, including high-end computational photography. So here's what that means. Pixel 3a can take amazing photos in low light with night sight. It's one of Pixel's most popular features. We've also enabled Pixel's portrait mode on both the front and rear cameras. And our SuperRes Zoom applies computational photography, so you can get closer to your subject while still maintaining a high degree of resolution. And all of your beautiful photos are backed up for free in high quality with Google Photos. Pixel 3a also has the helpful features you'd expect in a Pixel. Just squeeze the sides of your phone to bring up the Google Assistant. We're using the AI in Pixel 3a to help manage your phone calls, too. I'm pretty sure we all hate getting robocalls. And Call Screen uses Google speech recognition and natural language processing to help you filter out those unwanted calls. It's already screening millions of them. Now, you might remember last year, we shared our vision for using AR in Google Maps. Starting today on Pixel phones, when you use walking directions, instead of staring at that blue dot on your phone, you're going to see arrows in the real world to tell you where to turn next. We're just beginning our journey with AR and Maps, and we're really excited for Pixel users to experience this early preview. Battery life. It's one of the most important features on a smartphone. It makes sense. People need to know that their phone won't quit on them before the end of their day. Pixel 3a has adaptive battery. It uses machine learning to optimize based on how you use your phone. So you can get up to 30 hours on a single charge. And with the included 18-watt charger, you'll get up to 7 hours of battery life with just 15 minutes of charging. Pixel 3a doesn't compromise on security either. It's got the same comprehensive approach as Pixel 3. On the hardware side, our Titan M security chip protects your sensitive data on the device, like login credentials, disk encryption, app data, and OS integrity. On the software side, you get the latest Google security patches and updates for 3 years, including Android Q this summer. So instead of getting slower and less secure over time, your Pixel gets better with every update. We think this hybrid approach provides the strongest data protection. And in a recent Gartner report, Pixel scored the highest for built-in security among smartphones. Pixel 3a offers the complete Pixel experience, and we're proud to make it available and affordable to more people around the world. Verizon's been a great partner over the past 2.5 years in the US, and we're excited to be partnering with them again for the launch of Pixel 3a. And for the first time, we're expanding our US carrier partnerships. So the entire Pixel family is now available for sale at T-Mobile, Sprint, and US Cellular. You can also get Pixel 3a from the Google Store and use it on any US carrier, including Google Fi and AT&T. Pixel 3a and 3a XL are available in 13 markets starting today. You can find more details online at the Google Store. We're really excited to have you try it out. Next, Jeff will tell you about our efforts in Google AI. But first, here's a quick look at our new Pixel. Your head's in the clouds and what a feat for. They're stuck on the ground and I'm getting bored. Let's turn up the sound, best when messing around. Think it's time that we choose. So what you want to do? And I can't sit still. I'm not sure when I'll be finished, cause I got no chill. Pushing everybody's limits and they're like, for real? They know I'm gonna bring it, but it's no big deal, cause I'm on the come up.
Hey Google, you show me donut shops nearby.
Yeah, I'm on the come up. Come on. Think you can keep up? Bring the beat back. Come on. Homie, what you wanna do? Guess I'm out all day. For real?
We'll be right back.
Hi, everyone. Everything from building a low-cost premium device like the one you just saw without compromising on capabilities to developing a truly helpful assistant are all built on a tremendous amount of research and innovation under the covers. And they're examples of what we do at Google AI. Google AI is a collection of teams focused on making progress in artificial intelligence research across a wide range of different domains. We focus on solving fundamental computer science challenges in order to solve problems for people. That includes things like improving speech recognition models to answer questions faster or let you interact with your device quickly, or pushing the boundaries of computer vision to help people interact with their worlds in new ways, as you've seen today. We publish papers, release open source software, and apply our research to Google products. The goal is really to solve problems every day that touch billions of people. One of the things I'm most excited about is progress in language understanding. As Scott mentioned earlier, so much of our daily life depends on actually understanding language, reading traffic signs and shopping lists, writing emails, communicating with the people around us. We'd really want computers to have the same fluency with language that we do, not just understand surface forms of the words, but actually understand what sentences mean. Unlocking that would get us closer to our mission of organizing the world's information and making it universally accessible and useful. In the past few years, we've made major strides. Take teaching a machine to answer questions like this one about Carlsbad Caverns, a national park in New Mexico. Only recently, the state-of-the-art language architecture for language understanding was something called a recurrent neural network, or RNN. RNNs process words sequentially, one after another. They work well for modeling short sequences like sentences, but they struggle to make abstract associations, like knowing that stalactites and stalagmites are natural formations and that cement pathways, for example, are not. In 2017, we made a leap forward with our research on transformers, models that process words in parallel. 1 year later, we used it as a foundation for a technique we called bidirectional encoder representations from transformers. It's a bit of a mouthful, so we just call it BERT. BERT models can consider the full context of a word by looking at the words that come before and after it. They're pre-trained using plain text from the web and other textual sources. To do that, we use a process to train it that's a little like the word game of Mad Libs. We hide about 20% of the input words, and we train the model to guess those missing words. You can actually try this at home with a bit of text that you have. Hide a few words and see if you can guess what they are. That's effectively what we're doing. This approach is much more effective for understanding language. When we published the research, BERT obtained state-of-the-art results on 11 different language processing tasks. Fast forward to today, and we're excited to see how BERT can help us answer more complex questions that are relevant to you. Whether that's getting the flight time from Indiana to Honolulu, learning a new weightlifting exercise, or translating between languages. Research like this gets us closer to technology that can truly understand language. We're now working with product teams all across Google to see how we can use BERT to solve more problems in more places. We're excited to bring this to people around the world to help them get the information they need every day. All this machine learning momentum, though, wouldn't be possible without platform innovation. TensorFlow is the software infrastructure that underlies our work in machine learning and artificial intelligence. When we developed TensorFlow, we wanted everyone to be able to use machine learning, so we made it an open source platform. And while it's been essential to our work, we've been amazed to see what other people outside of Google have used it for all kinds of different things. We've seen engineers at Roma Tre University in Italy parsing handwritten medieval manuscripts. We've seen coders in France colorizing black and white photography. We've even seen companies developing fitness sensors for cows. The work that people are doing is really inspiring to us. It pushes us to keep asking ourselves, how can machine learning crack open previously unsolvable problems in order to help more people? One example is our work in the field of healthcare. We're really optimistic that our research can create real-world impact in medicine by improving solutions and establishing new diagnostic procedures. To share more, here's Dr. Lily Peng from the Google AI healthcare team.
Thanks, Jeff. So as a doctor, what I care about most is improving patients' lives. And that means good care and accurate diagnoses. That's why I was so excited 2 years ago at I/O when we shared our work in diabetic retinopathy. This is a complication of diabetes that puts over 400 million people around the world at risk for vision loss. Since then, we've been piloting this work with patients in clinical settings. Our partners at Verily recently received European regulatory approval for the machine learning model, and we have clinical deployments in Thailand and in India that are already screening thousands of patients. In addition to diabetes, one of the other areas we think AI can help doctors is in oncology. Today, we'd like to share our work on another project in cancer screening, where AI can help catch lung cancer earlier. So lung cancer causes more deaths than any cancer. It's actually the most common cause of death mortality, of death globally, accounting for 3% of annual mortality. We know that when cases are diagnosed early, patients have a higher chance of survival. But unfortunately, over 80% of lung cancers are not caught early. Randomized controlled trials have shown that screening with low-dose CTs can help reduce mortality, but there's opportunity to make them more accurate. So in a paper we are about to publish in Nature Medicine, we describe a deep learning model that can analyze CT scans and predict lung malignancies. To do it, we trained a neural network with de-identified lung cancer scans from our partners at the NCI, the National Cancer Institute, and Northwestern University. By looking at many examples, the model learns to detect malignancy with performance that meets or exceeds that of trained radiologists. So concretely, how might this help? Very early stage cancer is minuscule and can be hard to see, even for seasoned radiologists, which means that many patients with late-stage lung cancer have subtle signs on earlier scans. So take this case, where an asymptomatic patient with no history of cancer had a CT scan for screening. This scan was interpreted as normal. 1 year later, that same patient had another scan. It picked up a late-stage cancer, one that's much harder to treat. So we used our AI system to review that initial scan. So let's be clear, this is a tough case. We showed this initial scan to other radiologists, and 5 out of 6 missed this cancer. But our model was able to detect these early signs 1 year before the patient was actually diagnosed, translate to an increased survival rate of 40% for patients like this. So clearly, this is a promising but early result. And we're very much looking forward to partnering with the medical community to use technology like this to help improve outcomes for patients. Now I'll hand it back to Jeff.
Thanks, Lily. The same technologies that you just saw driving healthcare innovation have applications across almost every field imaginable. Our AI for Social Good program brings together our efforts to use AI to explore and address some of the world's most challenging problems. Last year, we announced the program in its two pillars, research and engineering, and building the external ecosystem. Let's talk first about research and engineering. One project where we're working that's already creating impact is our work on flood forecasting. Floods are the most common, deadliest natural disasters on the planet. Every year, they affect up to 230 million people across the world, more than storms and earthquakes combined. 20% of flood fatalities happen in India alone. This is a problem that we're even seeing this week with the impact from Cyclone Phoni. Floods prevent kids from being able to play in their neighborhoods, or parents from protecting and providing for their families, often because they don't have enough advance warning. And without consistent, accurate warning systems, people are prone to ignore warnings and be unprepared. That's especially detrimental in areas hit with annual monsoons. That's why, last fall, we shared our work on flood forecasting models that can more accurately predict flood timing, location, and severity. Through a partnership with India's Central Water Commission, we began sending early flood warnings to the phones of users who might be affected. Today, we're thrilled to announce the expansion of our detection and alerting system for the upcoming monsoon season. The expanded area will cover millions of people living along the Ganges and Brahmaputra river areas. Not only are we increasing the area of coverage, but we're also better forecasting where the floods will hit hardest. Through a new version of our public alerts, people can better understand whether they'll be affected so they can protect themselves and their families. Our model simulates water behavior across the floodplain, showing the exact areas that will be affected. We combine thousands of satellite images to create high-resolution elevation maps using a process similar to stereographic imaging to figure out the height of the ground. We then use neural networks to correct the terrain so it's even more accurate, and then we use physics to simulate how flooding will happen. We also collaborate with the government to receive up-to-date stream gauge measurements and send forecasts in real time. We're excited to continue working with partners to increase the accuracy and precision of these models, which we hope will make people safer from flooding all around the world. Research like this is critical. But we also know that AI will have the biggest impact when people from many different backgrounds all come together to develop new solutions to problems they see. That's why the second pillar of our AI for Social Good program is to build the external ecosystem. We want to empower everyone to use AI to solve problems they see in their communities. Last year, we partnered with Google.org to launch the Google AI Impact Challenge. It was a call for nonprofits, social enterprises, and universities to share their ideas for using AI to address societal challenges. We've received applications from 119 countries across six continents, representing all kinds of sizes and types of organizations. Today, we're really excited to announce the 20 selected. We even have a few of them with us today. Let's give them a warm welcome. Here's the list of organizations. These organizations are working on some of the world's most meaningful issues. La Fondation Médecins Sans Frontières is using image recognition to help medical staff analyze antimicrobial images in order to prescribe the right antibiotics for bacterial infections. New York University, in partnership with the Fire Department of New York City, is building a model to help speed up emergency response times. This could really improve public health and safety. And Makerere University in Uganda will use AI to create a high-resolution monitoring network to shape public policies for improving air quality. We'll be supporting our 20 grantees in bringing these ideas to life. We're providing $25 million in funding from Google.org, as well as coaching and resources from teams all across Google. Congratulations to all our grantees. As we head into the next decade, I'm really excited about what's to come. There are so many promising avenues for fundamental research. For instance, machine learning models today, typically we can get them to be good at solving individual tasks. But what if they could generalize across thousands of tasks, solving new problems faster, and with just a few examples to learn from? The keys to progress on these kinds of research problems are those most human characteristics, perseverance and ingenuity. As you heard Sundar mention at the start of the day, we're moving from a company that helps you find answers to a company that also helps you get things done. And all the products we showed you today share a single goal: to be helpful. At the same time, we want to ensure that the benefits of technology are felt everywhere, continue to uphold our foundation of user trust, and build a more helpful Google for everyone. To everyone joining us on the live stream, thank you for tuning in. And to everyone here with us in the audience today, welcome to Google I.O. 2019. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of I.O.
Something. We're back after the Google I.O. live stream is over. We're going to try to unpack all of that stuff.
That's a different event, though, unpacked.
If you try to watch the last 20 minutes, it was a little bit dense, but it's about the future. I'm Iyaz Akhtar alongside Vanessa Hand, Orellana.
Hey.
Patrick Holland.
Hello, hello.
And Stephen Beecham behind the board saluting at things. Okay, guys. So as we're watching this two-hour keynote, now, oh, my bad, an hour and 45 minutes. So it wasn't exactly
Don't
2 hours.
Don't exaggerate, buddy.
Yeah. It had some pacing problems, I want to say, and the effects weren't very good. That's why I'm thinking of a movie. But the biggest oohs and ahs for this entire thing, we were keeping track of this as this was going on. The first time we heard the audience audibly respond was when you were able to use Google AI to split a tab or figure out a tip using the Google camera. Google camera, I can't say that.
What Google, did you think Google of, Lens.
Yeah, Google Lens.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I mean... I hate to say it, but I told you so. But no, it's the like small,
the small things.
It's the small things that like affect your day-to-day life and make things slightly easier. Obviously, anybody can calculate a tip. You whip out the calculator, but this is saving you one step. And, you know, it has the potential to affect your day-to-day, whereas some of the other things that we saw, you know, like this amazing, the cancer screening and the AI being able to detect cancer in a CT scan earlier than a doctor, that's amazing stuff, but that likely doesn't have the potential to affect, hopefully, me directly quite yet, and we won't see it as consumers for a while now. So I feel like it was warranted, the ooh. Not to say that the other stuff didn't warrant the ooh, but I see why people got excited about that.
Also, in context, that was one of the first early announcements.
Sure.
So it definitely ramped up. It wasn't they were like, hey, we're going to detect cancer. The tip thing, though, that's not the
only thing. But it is neat because I think of like some of the features they've had out before this. Like one of my favorite ones on the Pixel is it disidentifies the song playing if you're in a restaurant.
Yeah,
it is. The now playing is amazing. I love it. I miss it when I'm not on the Pixel 3 and I'm on a different phone for review. But it's those little things. It's those conveniences. And when you make it appealing and something that, like, how many, everybody, no matter, like, age, race, gender, you know, has had to deal with a tab or a bill at some point. Well, maybe not a five-year-old, but, you know.
They'll be able to do it.
They'll be able to do it. And I think, you know, you got to wonder, like, is, like, the next step after that, like, would that be, like, it's just going to do it and then, like, make your Google pay for your portion and make my Venmo pay for mine. You know, like what's the next step after that?
I mean, that definitely seems like something that would be very advantageous to the developers. They'd be like, oh, wait a second. Now that Google's showing they're going to have this from the OS level, let's see what we can do with this. So that seems like the next step, because one of the lines that the presenter said was, it can't split it for you yet, or something like that. We can't split up the tabs for the bills that way yet, which sounds like they will probably work that in. The second biggest oohs and ahs was being able to stop a Google timer by saying the word stop. So if you use Google Home and you say, set a timer for X amount of minutes, when it goes off, you have to say, okay, Google, or hey, Google, and I'm really sorry to set off my own phone right there.
You just set up everyone's phone.
Sorry about that, folks. Thanks. Anything's possible, says my phone.
Stop. It doesn't work.
You can yell the word stop, and it'll actually stop beeping. People are excited about that, too. Another small thing, that's two for you, Vanessa.
Two for me. Thank you. Well, I mean, the other thing that wasn't as big of an ooh, but was big for me was the duplex on the web that mm-hmm. can fill out your forms. I mean, that's another... Okay, that's not quite as small as splitting your bill. That's pretty huge, I would say. But it's one of those things that maybe didn't get an ooh that I think deserved one, only because just filling out forms is such a menial task. And I remember last year when Google Duplex came on stage and made a hair appointment, people were impressed but also kind of freaked out because they were like, oh, well, now we're going to be interacting with robots. But like filling out forms and doing all these menial tasks that can potentially... save you a lot of time. I mean, I'm all for it, even if, yes, you have to acknowledge the creepy factor of some of these new features. But I think it's a great second feature for Google Duplex. It's a great step in the right direction, and I would definitely sign up for that.
And also, I think the way they like framed Google Duplex this year, and obviously you have to see a lot more features and mm-hmm. implementation was... so smart. And I mean, the creepy like meme that got ahead of the news last year, you know, whether that was fair or not, you could argue about that. But on the flip side, like just seeing it in so many different situations where it could be useful, again, that convenience factor, that that's appealing. If something's mm-hmm. convenient, I don't have to fill out a form, that's appealing to me. Let's do it. Sign me up, or I'll tell it to sign me up. Because
I just want to be able to take Google Duplex to go to the DMV for me. And, yes. You know, right?
Well, it'll be a new partnership.
Would either of you ever use Google Duplex to make a hair appointment? Honestly, just curious.
If my yes. guy took appointments, I definitely would. Because I definitely need to make appointments for this dang haircut. But yeah, definitely taking the streamlining aspect, because they also showed off the thing I loved the most was the next generation assistant, where all this information, all this... AI is happening on your phone directly instead of going to the cloud and back. So when they showed this demo, if this thing works anywhere nearly as well as this does in this demo, where you have the ability to just, you know, change apps, make the phone turn the flashlight on, just text, voice to text, all of these options that usually take a lot longer because it's going to the cloud and coming back, going to the cloud and coming back, that also saves tons of time. So then you'd be able to easily say to Duplex, hook this up.
But Iyaz, we already have something like that. If you have a Samsung phone, you have Bixby.
Yeah, Bixby's in a lot of trouble right now, right?
I feel bad.
I mean,
Bixby
any assistant that has to compete with Google Assistant after that demo is in trouble. I mean, honestly, it's going to make everybody ditch their assistant, install Google Assistant on their phone, because honestly, there's nothing quite out there that can react as fast. And we were talking about this too. It kind of is also starting to pave the way for other non-mobile devices to be able to use voice control, because mm-hmm. in order for you to be able to use something like a headset or something like that, where you don't have manual controls, where you can't tap on a screen, it's important and I would say extremely necessary to be able to have that seamless voice command control and be able to have the contextual responses, contextual searches, and the zero lag time. So I think this is just the beginning of this kind of voice control Google Assistant interaction.
And I think, and also to be a little fair to that too, I also think like when we start comparing like Siri and Bixby and these other things, it's like they're all still really early on. Mm-hmm. I mean, the way that these will be optimized even like 3 to 5 years is going to be completely different and run completely smoother, faster, hopefully. But yeah, it is interesting. Like there's some significant things that they put their poll down, and when it's like Apple's event, it's in June, right? Yep. So you got about a month to wait to see kind of with what they might respond with. It's stuff they're already working on, obviously. So it's not like they're going to, well, they made that. We can make that too, you know? But it is very exciting, especially going across devices. I don't just have to have it on a phone or a hub or a pair of headphones. I could have it on all of them.
Yeah, I mean, yesterday, Google at Build, Microsoft Build, they showed off something similar with Cortana, where it's like very conversational. There's like this really long video of a woman. She's talking to her phone for like a good 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. But it's the same kind of thing, and it's also over multiple devices, so you don't have to, you know, use a certain device for a certain assistant and stuff. So, you know, they're all coming out with a similar thing right now. And Cortana was actually, that was a pretty good demo yesterday. If you watch our Microsoft Build highlights video on our YouTube channel, you could check out that video. But it's, you know, they're all kind of going in that direction.
Well, that's a good point. I hadn't even considered Cortana as a player in this space, but you're right. I mean, Cortana might even be better positioned than, I mean, definitely Bixby, but Siri at this point.
Yeah, I mean, again, like, we're kind of like going, measuring like, oh, who's ahead of the first four or five steps of the marathon? Who's going to win the marathon? But it's like, it's such a long race. But I would say
Google
this,
just
like,
sprinted forward, I'll tell
Google
you that
sprinted
much.
Forward,
yeah.
And then I would also say going to Cortana, like, that's the other thing too, is like, if I'm on my phone and then I want to be on my TV or I want to be on
your speaker,
a speaker, whatever, I wanted to kind of at least feel like it remembers me and what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. So, and right now I feel like that's a weakness of some of these other assistants.
I think we mentioned Microsoft like too many times because like the Skype thing's going off. I'm pretty
sure. Now we have Skype going
it's
on.
It's like
there.
Beetlejuice. So I'm pretty sure we're getting a call. Stephen will let us know when we're at the ready there. When it comes to Google, I know we're talking about, we're nitpicking on assistant. I wanted to say one more thing about this. The amount of users that Google has, the amount of data it can collect. Microsoft has, you know, user base and everything. I don't know how many people are participating, helping Cortana along. The way Google showed how it's changing the way Gboard gets smarter, the mm-hmm. way anything gets smarter, it's because they have this massive user base. And even with the Pixel getting cheaper, the Pixel 3a, which we'll talk about soon, that will get more pixels, more most up-to-date Android in more hands, to give Google even more information so their assistant gets smarter.
So we got Scott Stein on the line.
All right, where are you, Scott?
Hey, Scott.
Oh, he
Scott
just froze.
Stein is,
oh, no.
Or potentially very serious in the
very
moment.
Very dramatic froze, too.
We'll see if we can get him back.
Well, he's just for context, he's at Google I.O. right now. He's mm-hmm. probably, we're going to ask him a little bit about what, about the actual oohs and ahs and which one being there, which one he thought was maybe the loud, received
which one deserved
the loudest.
The most oohs? Which
well,
one
or,
what, is, what his personal ooze would be?
Yeah,
his
exactly.
personal ooze might be different
personal
than
personal ooze sounds mass, like a very disgusting.
And also,
ooze.
Did they have anything waiting for them under the seat? I'm kidding.
Yeah, a book by Oprah's friend, Gail King. I'm kidding. While we're waiting for him, like what? Another one. I think we heard this with Apple last year was dark mode coming for the Mac, but dark mode coming.
That got a big
one,
ooh. That
awesome.
a big ooh.
That
for
was
sure.
That was cheer number three. Yes,
right,
and
we got
it's
him
such
back.
A simple thing, but so great.
Scott Stein joining us from Google I.O. How's it going?
Hey, Scott.
Hey, how are you doing?
Hello, hello.
Good. You know, we were going over the biggest oohs and ahs, and so far we had splitting a tab with Google Lens was huge, saying stop to a timer, people were cheering. What were your personal amazing moments?
Well, I was closest to the AR stuff, so I thought that stuff was pretty fascinating, although could be really in the weeds because if you're not following the evolution, I think it's where Google's going. The ambition to kind of make a visual assistant that will try to be like what voice assistant does down the road, so maybe for headsets. I think the hardware is cool. I think the Pixel 3a, I mean, they needed a phone like that. I'm curious to see what it's like, and there's a review. I think the actually I think what really interested me was live captions, the ability again for AI to assist people, I think was great. Driving mode, I mean, again, like I don't think driving assistance is good enough right now for if you have a phone versus like buying the car with that built in. So I like that they're pushing in that direction. The Nest Hub Max, which I can't, I that name is a weird name. That's
it's
like
horrible
a
name. Horrible name.
Yeah,
terrible.
It's a total like performing stage name or something. So I am Nest Hub Max. That I think it's totally confusing because last year that product was understandable and cool, and I even felt confused by the name change when really all it's adding is a camera. So, and then the question of like, how useful is that camera going to be? It's intriguing. I kind of felt like it was like a little less exciting than I thought it was going to be. 10x faster Google Assistant is cool, but that's like, you kind of expect that at Google I.O. You know, they're going to talk about turbocharging their AI and blast that. I don't know, focus mode? I'm like kind of scratching my head with that, literally. Like any of that digital wellness and digital health stuff reminds me a bit of the ambitions of fitness tracking, where that's great, but as long as it works for you, and if you think that that's going to make you healthier just because you're using that app, that's not a stand-in. So the focus mode just seems, again, like a type of like, don't distract me. Parental controls, I don't know, bonus screen time? Come on. Like, what are you doing?
We do that.
So, like, Q, there weren't, like, a ton of big features, but dark mode is cool. I think getting rid of the back button people were talking about. You know, those are, like, those are kind of the big ones for me. I think, you know, when I look back on this, I kind of felt like the show didn't end with a big bang.
No, it did not. It was kind of an abrupt ending. Did it feel abrupt out there as much as it did here on the viewer end?
It totally was abrupt. It was like a phone call. It was like a phone call with a relative, and they were like, okay, we'll talk to you soon. And they're like, wait, well, I thought we were going to talk. Okay, bye.
Were people filing out after the Pixel announcement? Is that what happened? Or did they just plan for it to
I
be
think
like...
We were all here, and then it was like, you know, where's Sundar? And like, isn't there going to be something wild and crazy? And then they're just, that's it.
A new product TV.
Right. And the products in the middle, I mean, it's true. You don't want to make this a product show, and it's not meant to be a product show. So you don't want to end with that because that feels like it's really stealing the thunder in a weird way. But it created a weird structure. When you have a product review breaking in the middle of I.O., that's an unusual structure.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
you know,
I mean, maybe they could have ended with that or started with that. You're right. It did seem a little weird.
Yeah. And then there are things, obviously, that we all want to know. I want to know a lot more about that we didn't hear about. We didn't expect to hear about them. But, for instance, Google Stadia, which was at GDC, we still want to hear more. We should be hearing more maybe along – I would expect alongside E3 or somewhere in that time frame. But nothing on that.
Well, let's talk about the things that you particularly or that you're hearing there, that the things that were missing or most notable missing – announcements that we wanted to hear more about. What would that be aside from Stadia for you, Scott?
Well, a couple of categories that were absent that I had gotten a sense would be absent. Stadia is one. VR, because you know what? Google has been really big into VR the last couple of years. Not a word. There. I mean, I got word from Clay, the head of VR and AR at Google. They're in deep R&D is what they're calling it. Now, does that mean like a mixed reality headset? Does that mean that they're rethinking everything? It's hard to tell, but like nothing on Daydream compatible. Pixel 3a is not Daydream compatible. So yeah, VR took a backseat, and wearables, nothing on wearables. So, I mean, where's Wear OS? There was an announcement on a software update before I.O.
Where is where?
And that matters, again, do we care as a product? No, but for developers, that's an interesting question. Like, what is the state of developers and Wear OS? Maybe there isn't much of a state for that. So I'm curious where that all lands. And I do miss the moonshot stuff. I kind of feel like this was like, we're a little light on big moonshot ideas. Google pulls crazy rabbits out of their hats every year. Like you go, what? I didn't even know. What is that? I don't even understand. It's amazing. I can't even understand it. But they're doing that. And I don't really feel like there was a big moment like that this year. Duplex last year.
Yeah.
I mean, Duplex, you know, like, what? Where was that? So you don't need that every year, but it helps.
Yeah.
I think them name checking Verily and kind of hinting about the smart contact lens was the closest we got to the, wait, what are you doing with this? But that was at the very end when everyone was kind of like, what are we watching? From the excited watch to what? That's where we went out here.
I was very obsessed with trying to count the number of people who were wearing Google Glass.
How many did you count?
I only got to two.
Only
Jason
two.
Cipriani bet me that fewer than 10 will be wearing Google Glass. You think he's right?
I think it's right. But yeah, what do you think?
I think there's got to be more than 10 at Google I.O. Like, I don't know if they all had them on, but like, I want to find the 10 and talk to them and hear what they feel
my
about that.
My dentist has a Google Glass.
What?
Yeah.
We look forward to that video, Scott. You need to get them on camera. You need to interview them, and then we need to see that video on CNET.com.
I also want to see it from their point of view since they have a camera on theirs.
They're all dentist developers.
That
like,
is
it's
great.
A big market for us.
Cavities oh my God.
Be gone.
When I find them, I'm going to record it on my phone.
Please.
I'm going to try to get profiles. And if you're listening, if anyone knows, if you have a friend who's wearing Google Glass at Google I.O., contact me because I want to talk to them. I want to hear about how you feel about it and why you're wearing it.
His wake word is, hey, Scott's dying.
Right.
Remember
it's
that.
It's because It's because you were wearing it on the train in 2013, Scott. That's why I'm wearing it.
Also, I want to give you one more piece of homework while you're down there, Scott. Will you look for any kind of hints as to the possible meaning of Android Q? It has been a heated debate over here. We have a couple contenders, but nothing really solid yet. So if you could provide any, shed any light as to what the Q stands for, maybe, you know, really hone in on what they're serving for lunch, what they're serving for dessert after lunch. Just, you know, just
Ooh,
watch out,
quiche,
please.
Yeah, there's no name, right?
No,
it's
name.
Just Q.
Yes, it's just Q. And there, it's, we've done it, done the due diligence, and there aren't a lot of desserts that start with Q. In fact, I would argue
quince.
That
maybe quince. That's like
what's
this
that?
Would be it.
It's a fruit, I believe, and was an answer on White Man Can't Jump in the Jeopardy section.
Also, name of a Shakespeare carrier in Midsummer Night's Dream. But
that's
yeah,
how I know it.
Hey, Scott, I'm going back to Android Q for a second. I'm wondering, too, if you're feeling like the things you saw today are like a big jump ahead or just more like, especially when it comes to like some of the privacy stuff, they were really pushing that a lot. What were your thoughts when you saw that?
The privacy stuff didn't seem as amazing. I mean, people are really privacy concerned now, and so I think you have to make a bigger splash with what you're doing. I don't know. It didn't really hit me that strongly here. It's good to be making statements about it, but it is sort of like a little bit vague, and you know, you don't really know what it's going to turn out to be. I think maybe the reason too why I think the bigger picture for Google is Android is starting to seem less exciting as a software update, but Google services are increasingly running cross-device.
Yeah.
And like, for instance, in the AR instance on Android Go for using Lens, Google's very proud of it not using hardware much, running in the cloud. And I think that the reliance on that and de-emphasizing hardware or even de-emphasizing specific software releases might be a sign of where Google's continuing to go. That it's, you know, it's like it's more important how these services manifest everywhere than in like, what's the next phone software update? Like, we may be nearing the end of that now.
So Scott, you got lots of homework to do. Sorry to cut you off.
Yeah.
You got lots of homework to do. Can you go out in the field and find everybody and do? I'm sure you got nothing else to do while you're there. So
that's my main goal now, is just to look for Q things and take pictures of Google Glass.
Yes.
And anything else you guys have. Sounds it's going to be nice.
I think that's going to keep you busy for the next, you know, couple hours, Scott. So
the next 3 or 4 days. Tonight we have the Google Night Party, which is like full of weird AR and AI experiments. So I'm looking forward to that.
Well, have fun. Thanks for checking in with us from Google I.O. live.
Thanks, Scott.
My voice is cracking. Thanks. It's dry.
Go drink some water.
Get some water. I need some water. Okay.
Or a quince.
Bye.
Bye. All right, so we haven't talked much about the Pixel 3a, which seems to hit every single leak we saw.
Yeah,
it's got an OLED screen, it's got a headphone jack, even though the Pixel 3 doesn't. It's got a price of $399. They didn't mention the XL, they showed it in the video, but since everything is, I believe everything's out, there's a second model. Yeah. People, there's 3XL, and you can get that as well
for $479.
$479, and one of the bigger moments for the Pixel 3, not only the price point, but it's available at a lot more carriers in the U.S. So it's going to be a T-Mobile, Sprint, U.S. Cellular, and Google Fi, and Verizon, because it's always at Verizon. So if you go to an AT&T store, you can't get it there. But I think a lot of people didn't realize, and Jess Delcourt did a great article about this, didn't realize that a Pixel can run on other networks beyond Verizon because they just never saw it there. This kind of exposure, I think, will be very good, especially at this price point. What do you think of the phone?
He's speechless.
No, honestly speechless. No, I would say this about the carrier stuff. I think that's always a sad thing that happens with some of the, especially a phone that, you know, we do think of Google Pixel as a flagship, but on the flip side, it is still a small phone and how many units they actually sell. Mm-hmm. And when it's tied to something like Verizon, even though it's an unlocked phone, and I could buy it from the Google Play Store, I still could still use it on AT&T or T-Mobile. A lot of people didn't know that. But that being said, going back to the more affordability, I'm so glad it hit that $399 mark. Again, if it was the $470 for the bigger one is compelling as well, because now you're getting to compare stuff to like the OnePlus 6T. Mm-hmm. But hitting that $400 mark, and I'm getting probably like the best known feature on it, which is the same camera as the Pixel 3, That is really cool. And I'm gaining. I gained some things like a headphone jack. I don't have that. But I do give up like wireless charging. So if that's important, water resistance, if that's important, then this might not be the one for you.
Yeah. Looking at the phones, I mean, the design is googly. It's exactly what the renders were. It looks like the three. It's got no notches. So it's got a very mid-range look to it. I'm not a big fan of the design. I wish it kind of go a little bit more edgy. I'm sure we're going to see that with the four. And now I'm just kind of nitpicking. For a $399 phone, that really does make it a lot more palatable. It doesn't have to look amazing. But then again, there are things like the Moto G Series that does have pretty nice design chops at a really low price. And that's the kind of thing that kind of makes me put this in context. It's not just that, oh, it's a low-cost Google phone. It's against everybody. But I also still am veering back to Pixel in general because the Android Q features, getting the updates right away, like the live captioning, which we sort of mentioned, Scott mentioned that these things are coming to Q. And you're not going to be able to get Q on a lot of other devices unless you're willing to wait. I just got Android Pie on my Note 8 in April. So I'm like, cool, I can do Netflix picture in picture finally, because it always would close. This is.
But it's just, it's another, I think the device marks a great moment for Google where, again, it's just trying to get more of these devices in more people's hands, being more affordable, and not having price be such a dependent factor on getting like cool features like the camera and stuff. I mean, Vanessa, you've had some experience with these Pixels too, like what do you think?
I totally agree with you. I think that, you know, for me, the camera would be the biggest feature, and the fact that it does have a lot of the same features except for maybe that secondary lens on the front, which I never used anyway. But the, you know, the night sight, or the being able to the portrait mode, things that you normally maybe wouldn't get on the lower tier device, that you still get on the cheaper Pixel for $400. That's pretty huge. It opens up this market for it opens up these devices for a whole different market that we were talking about, and one that isn't even catered to by Apple or Samsung, at least with their flagship models at this point. So I think they, you know, they might have hit a sweet spot. We'll have to see the adoption rate of the Pixel phone, because obviously it isn't as the brand recognition with the hardware of Google is not quite as much as a Samsung or an Apple, for example. But I think, you know, I think it's definitely a step in the right direction to lower that price point and being able to bring all those features.
And also, it's a price point that currently Apple doesn't have. I think you can get like a new iPhone 7 for like $500, but to get a brand new phone that was made just recently.
I think the SE came back in for like a brief moment, which was maybe the closest thing. But then that's like a long time ago's phone. At least.
Components. But I think the neat thing about this is kind of like I feel like the Pixel 3a is kind of like the Toyota Corolla, where it's not the Camry, it's not the Prius, but it's going to be fine for most people, and it's probably going to be a big seller for these guys.
I would put it above the Corolla, just because it does have a great camera feature and a lot of flashier features that, you know, kind of set it apart from just your...
And that is not a knock on a Corolla.
No.
A good Corolla.
Those are reliable. They work. They're very popular.
But meaning, like, it's just supposed to be that, like, very easy to use.
I would say it's more like a smart car, you know?
Hybrid
electric vehicle.
Okay, I'll give you the hybrid. It's like an affordable Prius, maybe.
Right, exactly.
But I think there's a lot of, like, Apple users who would be surprised if they picked up a Pixel phone and tried to just how clean the experience is, and how, I don't want to say Apple-like, but just how easy it is to navigate and use things. And every year, Google gets better and better with the hardware and the software. Are they going to take on something like the iPhone XR or the XS? Probably not.
Probably not.
But if I'm upgrading and I'm not like tied into iMessage or something like that, it's a compelling thought to save. Just, I could buy, two of these phones and still have
$100.
Two and a half almost. Two of these phones that have money left over for the price of an iPhone.
Well, and it's pretty telling because, Patrick, you're an iOS user as well. And, you know, through many of your videos, we've learned that perhaps the Pixel would be the phone to make you jump ship. And you, in fact, it's made you jump ship on occasion, because sometimes you use it more than an iPhone. And, you know, for you, Iyaz, we know that you are an Android guy, but you're a Samsung guy right now.
Right now, I've got my Note. I've got an iPad that's a million years old. I've got an iPhone 10 from work.
But the Pixel would be that phone to make you jump ship from Samsung.
The Pixel, yes, because it's the updates. When I was looking at the features of Android Q, we're talking about this in the pre-show, nothing was that exciting. After this, I was way more excited because of the things like live captions, which would be system-wide. They had Smart Reply, which would be Android Q system-wide. So if I'm using any messaging app, whether it's WhatsApp or Signal or anything, smart replies are built into that. So it's one thing that's really cool to do with Gmail, but to mm-hmm. save time doing this on the systems level, pretty huge. Back to the Pixel thing again, though. Number four cheer, the biggest cheer, was the headphone jack on the Pixel 3a. Now, they also showed off AR on the 3a running on the Google Maps side,
yep.
which was a nice, I thought, little like move to go, hey, it's powerful. It's pretty powerful. Mm-hmm, it can still do this. I thought that was a neat thing. They talked about the adaptive battery. They're claiming 30 hours of battery life on the, I guess, the small one, because they don't think they specifically mentioned the 3a XL at all. We also have a small amount of storage on board. 64 gigabytes. Now, the big hook is supposed to be Google Photos cloud storage.
Asterisk, asterisk, right. asterisk.
A lot of asterisks.
So instead of getting total original quality being uploaded forever, I believe you get a compressed high quality for a year, or I'm not sure about the timing on how long your photos will be backed up. So that's
but it's
kind
definitely
of a,
not indefinite.
Right.
Definitely
it's not, indefinite, not indefinite. And it's not going to be the highest quality. Right. So that's could be a... an issue.
But going back to like the Pixel 3, one of my biggest issues with it is the battery. Like it's just hard to make it through a day of even like moderate use. So if they have like solved that a bit for the 3A, I think that's a very compelling thing. And the other thing too is you're talking about like the AR
on maps.
Demo on maps and stuff like that is I think we were talking about this during the show, that as much as it is about Android Q, it's also about like these kind of components of Google, like Google Maps, Google Lens. And that's not just an Android thing, right? And I think that's interesting because, like, you start seeing, like, is there just going to be, like, is Google Maps just going to be one app that has all this in it and you download it on your phone? Like, I can get directions. I can take see pictures of the food I want to order from a restaurant.
That was intriguing.
That was cool.
And stuff like that, right? It's just neat to see that as they're building this out, it's as much about Android as it is, like, these core components of, like, their big apps.
Yeah, Google's definitely integrating all kinds of data from all kinds of things between maps and using Lens, so you can look at a menu and it'll highlight the objects that are the most popular, show you pictures of that from Maps through Lens or Google search using AR. They're really kind of mixing things and melding them in ways that appear to be logical. It's not like, okay, I got to go through this app for this app for that thing. And I think that's kind of a slow evolution of this, because as we use these phones, we're finding out how we really want to use them. And I think a lot of this part of this keynote was about saving time, maybe making it more convenient. And that's something that it might not go, ooh, ah, like people did, but this kind of stuff does matter on the day-to-day basis. Because if you could do stuff quicker on your phone, battery life is longer, right? And you're doing other things in real life. So I think this was a, even though it was somewhat underwhelming because of all the leaks, I thought it was pretty, I'm a little hopeful on this side. Like, this is actually a pretty neat look as to what we'll see from developers in the future.
Yeah, and that's it. This is like as much for us to be excited about, but if I'm a developer, like, wow, I'm excited to get my hands on some of this and see how I can integrate it into my apps or into something I'm working on.
I'm curious, Steven, you're also not a Pixel user quite yet. Would any of these system-wide features from the Pixel 3a or that we saw just from Android Q, would it be enough to make you jump ship from your current phone without revealing which your current phone is?
I'm thinking about it. I have an iPhone 6S, so I'm pretty old school.
Yes.
But yeah, I use Maps like crazy, and I almost use Maps just like a Google search for everything.
Right.
You know? I mean, you can't get everything, but clearly I find restaurants and everything I need on there, and then I'll find their website or whatever. So, yeah, I mean, definitely. I've been thinking about making the switch.
Do you have a Google Assistant on your iPhone?
Oh, yeah. I love it.
Would the price point be something that you're going to factor in? I mean, would the 3, like when, if you were to consider the Pixel, for example, would you consider the 3A because of the price point, or would you look at more of the hardware stuff?
Definitely price point. Like my wife and I were talking about upgrading our phones, and we're like, the new iPhones are over $1,000, you know, but then my dad and my mom, they just got new Galaxy S10s, and they got like a Galaxy S10e
So
they got one for free when they went to T-Mobile, and my dad's like, oh, my plan's so cheap, and now I got this cool phone, and his camera looked great. So I'm like, what am I doing?
Yeah.
I'm paying like $100 a month for an iPhone. So yeah, definitely.
Yeah, Apple's definitely pricing out a lot of consumers out of the ecosystem, and now, you know, with Pixel doing a lot more to attract users and it being available on more networks, it's definitely making the transition easier on people and less of a, you know, a struggle or, even with the iOS to Android change.
Well, we see that value, right? It's like as you have a phone, as it gets older, is that value worth paying $1,000 or worth whatever it is, like $17 or $33 or more a month for 30 months? But, you know, outside the U.S., again, there's so many great budget and mid-range phones. And it's just neat to see. I mean, yeah, if Apple launched a budget range like 10C, like C for cheap or something like that, that would be compelling if it was like a $500 phone, right? If Samsung, they do have some lower, more budget-friendly phones.
In different countries.
They're not always here. But like stuff like you were talking about the S10e, Stephen. Like,
yeah.
It's such a great phone, but it's still $750.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we've seen some real issues with smartphone market growth in general. There's new cycles 3 years at a time now. People are waiting to upgrade because the features aren't moving as fast as their phones are staying fast and quick and simple. So like it's kind of a hard sell to make people keep shifting, especially since phones are no longer subsidized. You go with this cheaper option. Maybe this would be a way to get people to switch every 2 years, every 1 year. I don't know if that's going to happen.
Well, and we're seeing that as the phone market as a whole. I think like really the only company that made a big ton of money off their phones last year was Huawei.
Yeah.
Samsung didn't, and Apple, it's like lower than they expected, but maybe a bigger way to look at this is also why we see a lot of companies like Apple and Google really focusing on all their services and really focusing on all these convenience features, because that's really good what you want in a phone.
Well, and before we kind of end, because there were a couple of other announcements aside from the Pixel 3. One or 12. But like I felt like one of the themes that we haven't talked about that I felt like came through across all of the announcements was privacy. Google's had issues with privacy. Obviously, they needed to address them. Iyaz, what do you think? Do you think that what they mentioned, and you know, you mentioned Stephen Maps, they now have an incognito mode for Maps, which might be huge. Mm-hmm. Based on what we saw, do you think that was enough to address Google's issues with privacy right now?
I think it's a good start. There was a lot of damage control from a lot of people explaining privacy, security. Because there's been a lot of stuff in the press lately about, not just lately, the past year and a half or so. So it's damage control at this point. I think it's a good first step. If all these actions are being done on the phone, it's a lot more helpful, much more calming in the mind. You're not like going, oh, where's it going? What's going on? Like, it's all on my device. That makes it a lot more palatable for people to be using these kinds of what appears to be creepy features. I don't think they're that creepy. I think it's really cool when they work. I would love to live in the future that I see in movies, like just talking, it works.
And what were those devices? Case people, like, what are the devices that are not going to do it on device?
So on device, this is for Google Assistant on when you're asking anything, it'll be on your phone. The Nest Hub Max. Hub Max would do facial recognition on the device. So when you're training it for your face so you can get your own personalized recommendations, when it sees you, when you do this setup mode, it's doing all the analysis on the device, not being sent up and being brought back down.
And that's something actually, it is very similar to a little Facebook product they launched last year, which is Portal. And it had something very similar with the way it was able to recognize faces and doing that computation on device versus that. Now, obviously, if you had to compare privacy between Facebook and Google, obviously one seems to be a lot more.
Well, neither has a great track record, but one has a less tarnished one, I would say.
One's a serial, offender. Offender of that. Now, but on the flip side, obviously a very Apple thing to do, right? Is the on-device analysis and keeping it secure.
Well, and we kind of breezed past it, but Google also announced the other hardware announcement today was the Nest.
Nest Hub Max. Scott mentioned that it's that 10-inch. It's 10-inch device with a Nest Cam that can follow you around, sort of.
I
like that feature.
I liked it. I thought it was. Scott said he didn't like it, and I know they had the. What is it now? The Hub Max from last year that was $149, right?
That was the
renamed
Home Hub. Now it's the Nest Home Hub.
Oh my God.
It's very confusing because, Google renamed it to now go under the Nest brand. So now everything's Nest, not Google. Anyway, sorry, continue.
But as a product, despite the horrible naming scheme, it seems really compelling to me. Like, I've resisted a lot of these like little smart monitors in my home, but that one seems really compelling. And I could see myself not only getting one for me, but kind of like the way Facebook was trying to sell the Portal, getting one from like my dad having be able to talk to him, be able to like show him, like, you know, if I'm doing something, I'm not having to stop and just be planted in front of a camera. And, you know, even just having a picture frame as well. I know that seems very basic, but it seems very appealing, at least to me.
I totally agree with you, Patrick.
So they announced that there's like a button on the back that'll turn off the camera and the microphone, but I still don't trust that button or that switch.
I don't either. Yeah, because it turns it off, but it doesn't, like we were talking about,
doesn't have a physical switch.
Physical.
I'm sorry, it doesn't have a physical cover to the camera.
It doesn't physically cover it.
Well, and if
it's to electrically cut it off.
This is where, and it sounds like what it is actually doing is disabling the camera and microphone so they cannot work.
Or is it?
That would be the paranoia.
But that's the creepy voice you just made there is the doubt in your head. Again, not going back to the Facebook portal, they had the same button on theirs, but they also had like a lens cap that just went over it. So
see, that's better.
Yeah,
maybe getting a little sock for your home hub Max and covering up that that camera while you're...
That's the accessory. They'll be selling that on the Google store as well.
Maybe a little beanie. That's what I want.
Home hub Max beanie, camera beanie.
Oh, my God.
The beanie points to when the camera's looking at a different
direction. But that being said, it's very exciting, and the fact that it's coming out now, I'm curious to see what that price point hits in like the holidays as well.
That's the thing. It starts at $229, or at least that's the price right now for the Nest Hub Max, and the Nest Hub gets brought down to a price of $129.
Which makes it really attractive.
Black Friday deals for the Pixel 3a. The Nest Hubs are going to be really cheap,
insane.
And I think it's going to become like almost impulse buy.
I know.
Stuff,
wait, okay, how much is an Amazon Echo Show? Because that seems like that would
those
be
are
the...
around, I want to say like $99 or something like that, but they go down in price. They have sales on those.
Yeah, but
the
they
time.
Don't do anything well.
I mean,
okay. Echo Show. I'm sorry, I'm thinking of
price over function here. Iyaz, price over function.
$179 for the Echo Show second generation, 10.1 inch HD screen.
$179.
So,
and I agree that the camera feature. I mean, Nest has that brand recognition for camera features. So therefore, I already trust a little bit more than the Amazon Echo Show.
You know what,
just
the whole
because,
Nest thing
I know,
all that data
I know.
Was like out and about, and
well,
people were seeing that.
But also, they do have the history of doing cameras. I mean, I don't know.
This is this is going to be something.
Facial recognition.
Look, we could talk about this for I think another 45 hours.
Like, do you trust it or not?
I don't. I'd have to go to the bathroom.
Okay, so maybe not consecutively. So I think with this, I'm sure we're going to have lots of articles, honestly, about which cameras to set up, which ones are you going to trust? Mm-hmm. Because you got Nest, Amazon, and you've got so many other competitors out there. We got all these other phones. Should you buy the Pixel 3a or should you buy a last year flagship? Tons of questions.
I love that question. I love that question so much because it's such
sure
a good question.
We're
going
to have all of that such at CNET.com. Thanks to everybody for watching. Steven, thank you for being back there for ever.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Patrick, any last words?
Sweet quiche.
Quesadilla.
Nest Hub Max.
Ooh, that's...
Nest Hub Max.
That's such a mouthful.
All right, for CNET, I'm Iyaz Akhtar. Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Steven. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you next time.